this point as we are venturing out into the cosmos. The NASA administrator must have a strong scientific and a technical background, and the NASA administrator must not be political. And this is the point that my colleague from Florida, Senator Rubio, was making when, after being asked about his concerns over the administration's nomination of a political figure to head NASA, he said, and I quote, and by the way, I went to Marco and asked him if he minded that I quoted this quote that was in the newspaper, and he said, please do. Quote, I just think it could be devastating for the space program. And he further said, quote, it's the one federal mission which has largely been free of politics, and it's at a critical juncture in its history, end of quote. And so I believe, Mr. Chairman, that the nominee falls short of these three areas that I discussed. So let's proceed.
Thank you, Senator Nelson. I think we have a quorum, and we've got a couple of folks that we're going to lose here before too long. So we'll entertain a motion on the first agenda items.
Mr. Chairman, I now move that agenda item 2, the Joseph Stanford Jr. Channel renaming bill, be adopted and reported favorably without amendment.
Is there a second?
Second.
Second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to. Senator Nelson.
Mr. Chairman, I move that agenda item 1, the Stop Enabling Sex Traffickers Act of 2017 as modified by the Thune substitute, be adopted and reported favorably as modified with the amendment in the nature of a substitute.
Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor say aye. Aye. Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to. I recognize Senator Wicker for the next motion.
Mr. Chairman, I move that agenda item 5, the nomination of Neil Jacobs to be Assistant Secretary of Commerce, Environmental Observation and Prediction. Agenda item 6, the nomination of Bruce Landsberg to be a member of the National Transportation Safety Board. Agenda item 7, the nomination of Raymond Martinez to be Administrator of the Federal Motor Carrier Safety Administration. Agenda item 8, the nomination of Nazaktar Nikaktar to be Assistant Secretary of Commerce, Industry, and Analysis. And agenda item 10, the nomination of Leon Westmoreland to be a director of the Amtrak Board of Directors, be reported favorably.
Is there a second? There is a second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, no. The ayes have it. The motion is agreed to. Senator Blumenthal wants to be. Senator Blumenthal wishes to be recorded as a no.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Mr. Chairman, if I could be.
Senator Cantwell.
If I could be recorded no on Mr. Westmoreland and Mr. Landsberg.
The clerk. Okay. Yes. Very good. Anything else? Yes. All right. Senator Schatz.
Please record me as a no on Landsberg and Westmoreland.
Yes.
So noted. Senator Booker.
Please record me as a no also on Landsberg and Westmoreland.
Senator Peters.
I'd record it as a no vote on Landsberg and Westmoreland.
Okay. Senator Baldwin.
I would like to be recorded as a no vote on
Mr. Westmoreland. Got that. Senator Hassan.
I'd like to be recorded as a no vote on Mr. Jacobs, Mr. Landsberg, and Mr. Westmoreland. Thank you.
Okay. Senator Cortez Masto.
I'd like to be recorded as a no vote on Mr. Westmoreland.
Got all that?
Yes.
Mr. Chairman.
Senator Nelson.
For Senator Markey, he would like to be recorded no on Jacobs and Westmoreland. And Senator Duckworth would like to be a no on Landsberg and Westmoreland.
So noted.
I want to clarify my no vote on Westmoreland, Landsberg, and Jacobs.
Got it.
Got it all?
Yes.
Okay. All right. I think we're ready to move on. Senator Wicker.
Mr. Chairman, I move that agenda item 3, the nomination of Dana Bioko to be Commissioner of the Consumer Product Safety Commission, be reported favorably.
Is there a second?
There is a second.
Mr. Chairman, could we have a roll call vote, please?
Roll call vote has been requested. The clerk will call the roll.
Senator Wicker.
Aye.
Senator Blunt.
Aye.
Senator Cruz.
Aye.
Senator Fisher.
Aye.
Senator Moran.
Aye.
Senator Sullivan.
Aye.
Senator Heller.
Aye.
Senator Inhofe.
Aye.
Senator Lee.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Senator Capito.
Aye.
Senator Gardner.
Aye.
Senator Young.
Aye.
Senator Nelson.
No.
Senator Cantwell.
No.
Senator Klobuchar.
No by proxy.
Senator Blumenthal.
No.
Senator Schatz.
No.
Senator Markey.
No by proxy.
Senator Booker.
No.
Senator Udall.
No.
Senator Peters.
No.
Senator Baldwin.
No.
Senator Duckworth.
No by proxy.
Senator Hassan.
No.
Senator Cortez Masto.
No.
Chairman Thune.
Aye.
The ayes are 14, the nays are 13.
Motion is agreed to. Senator Wicker.
Mr. Chairman, I move that agenda item 4, the nomination of James Bridenstine to be Administrator of the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, be reported favorably.
Is there a second?
Second.
There is a second.
Please, a roll call, Mr. Chairman.
Roll call's been requested. The clerk will call the roll.
Senator Wicker.
Aye.
Senator Blunt.
Aye.
Senator Cruz.
Aye.
Senator Fisher.
Aye.
Senator Moran.
Aye.
Senator Sullivan.
Aye.
Senator Heller.
Aye.
Senator Inhofe. Senator Lee.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Senator Capito. Senator Gardner.
Aye.
Senator Young.
Aye.
Senator Nelson.
No.
Senator Cantwell.
No.
Senator Klobuchar.
No by proxy.
Senator Blumenthal.
No.
Senator Schatz.
No.
Senator Markey.
No by proxy.
Senator Booker.
No.
Senator Udall.
No.
Senator Peters.
No.
Senator Baldwin.
No.
Senator Duckworth.
No by proxy.
Senator Hassan.
No.
Senator Cortez Masto.
No.
Chairman Thune.
Aye.
The ayes are 14, the nays are 13.
The motion is agreed to. Senator Wicker.
Mr. Chairman, I move that agenda item 9, the nomination of Diana Furchgott Roth to be Assistant Secretary, to be an Assistant Secretary of Transportation, be reported favorably.
Is there a second?
Second.
There's a second.
Request a roll call.
Senator Wood has requested a roll call vote. Clerk will call the roll.
Senator Wicker.
Aye.
Senator Blunt.
Aye.
Senator Cruz.
Aye.
Senator Fisher.
Aye.
Senator Moran.
Aye.
Senator Sullivan.
Aye.
Senator Heller.
Aye.
Senator Inhofe.
Aye.
Senator Lee.
Aye.
Senator Johnson.
Aye.
Senator Capito. Senator Gardner.
Aye.
Senator Young.
Aye.
Senator Nelson.
No.
Senator Cantwell.
No.
Senator Klobuchar.
No by proxy.
Senator Blumenthal. Senator Schatz.
No.
Senator Markey.
No.
Senator Booker.
No.
Senator Udall.
No.
Senator Peters.
No.
Senator Baldwin.
No.
Senator Duckworth.
No by proxy.
Senator Hassan.
No.
Senator Cortez Masto.
No.
Chairman Thune.
Aye.
The ayes are 14, the nays are 13.
The motion is agreed to. I want to thank the members of the committee for their, I know there's a lot of other stuff going on right now, for helping us get through those items on the agenda. And we will now shift and make the transition into the hearing. So if we will ask our panelists to come forward and we'll proceed. Executive session is adjourned.
Take that binder.
Oh, you have that one.
Yeah.
Just
My vote should be changed to being in person because I would have just switched them. I was here.
Okay. Hey, Nick. Nick, Ed wants to be recorded as having been here.
I was here. I didn't ask permission to do so. Absolutely.
We'll take care.
Switch me to having been in person.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Good. Thank you.
All the proxy votes, right?
Same vote, but just in person.
Good morning. Now that our executive session is complete, we turn to the issue of data breaches. Data breach is not a new issue for the committee to explore. In fact, the committee has been focused on the consumer impact of data breaches since before I was elected to the United States Senate. The September 2004 Choice Point breach, what many consider to be the first high-profile data breach of the modern era, prompted a number of investigations from this committee, from the FTC, and from federal and state authorities. For those that don't remember, Choice Point was a data aggregation company originally created by Equifax, who, as fate would have it, is represented here today. In terms of the trajectory of congressional inquiry into major data breaches, you might say we've come full circle. In the intervening years, Congress and this committee in particular have paid close attention to data breaches, big and small. In addition, the committee has entertained a variety of proposals to strengthen data security requirements for companies across the board, as well as to impose federal requirements for affected companies to notify their consumers following the discovery of a breach. Sadly, we're truly in the era of major data breaches. These include the large-scale breaches at Equifax and Yahoo that we are examining today. While the Yahoo breaches are larger in terms of affected consumers, the Equifax breach is potentially much more severe given the sensitive nature of the consumer information compromised. In fact, I've heard from many constituents in South Dakota who are concerned about the lasting effects of the Equifax breach. I've also heard complaints it is difficult to set up a credit freeze and questions about whether credit monitoring is an effective tool to prevent identity theft. The Equifax breach reportedly exposed the sensitive personal data of about 145.5 million U.S. consumers, including their names, social security numbers, birth dates, addresses, and in some cases, driver's license numbers. Also exposed were the credit card numbers for more than 200,000 U.S. consumers and dispute documents containing personal identifying information for more than 180,000 U.S. consumers. Today, Equifax will have an opportunity to provide an update regarding the breach, as well as its much criticized efforts to mitigate the harm and prevent anything like this from happening again. The Yahoo breach we will discuss today compromised over 3 billion user accounts and followed a prior breach in which hackers stole similar types of information from at least 500 million users. The compromised data included names, telephone numbers, dates of birth, partial passwords, unencrypted security questions and answers, backup email addresses, and employment information. The 3 billion figure constitutes the entirety of the Yahoo Mail and other Yahoo-owned accounts at the time of the breach. Today, Yahoo representatives will have an opportunity to provide an update regarding these breaches, as well as efforts to mitigate the harm and ensure the security of consumer data going forward. The massive data breaches at Equifax and Yahoo illustrate quite dramatically that our nation continues to face constantly evolving cyber threats to our personal data. Companies that collect and store personal data on American citizens must step up to provide adequate cybersecurity, and there should be consequences if they fail to do so. The committee's made cybersecurity a priority, and I'm hopeful that today's hearing will help the committee to better understand these challenges as it considers legislation to address data breach notification and data security issues. When there is a risk of real harm stemming from a breach, we must make sure that consumers have the information that they need to protect themselves. That's why I support a uniform federal breach notification standard to replace the patchwork of laws in 48 states, in addition to the District of Columbia, in three other territories. A single federal standard would ensure all consumers are treated the same with regard to notification of data breaches that might cause them harm. Such a standard would also provide consistency and certainty regarding timely notification practices, benefiting both consumers and businesses. In order to ensure that businesses secure information appropriately, I've also advocated for uniform, reasonable security requirements to protect consumer data based on the size and scope of the company and the sensitivity of the information. However, in this regard, the facts of the Equifax breach are particularly troubling. As a credit bureau, Equifax was already subject to the safeguards rule under the Graham-Leach-Bliley Act, which is considered to be a stringent regulation. Nevertheless, the Equifax breach occurred, and its implications on American consumers appear dire. Enhancing security and protecting the personal data of American consumers will continue to be a priority for this committee. So I want to thank all of our witnesses for appearing here today, and I look forward to hearing your testimony. I'll now turn to Senator Nelson for his opening remarks.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. And this, as you stated, is the latest edition in the long history of hearings that we've held on this committee to discuss data security and breaches. I want to thank several senators on this committee have asked for this hearing. Senator Baldwin in particular, Senator Cortez Masto, thank you for all the more bringing this to the forefront. And so if you start with the massive breach of the ChoicePoint breach in 2005, and then continuing with Target, Neiman Marcus, Shape Hat, Sony, Citigroup, CVS, South Shore Hospital, Heartland Payment Systems, and many, many others, the parade of high-profile data breaches seems to have no end, and billions of consumers have had their sensitive personally identifiable information compromised, including Social Security numbers, driver's licenses, addresses, dates of birth. For years going forward, criminals can use this data to steal the identity of innocent consumers and create fake accounts in their names and commit other types of fraud. And I might point out that right now we estimate $5 billion a year is being stolen from the U.S. Treasury just on fake federal income tax returns, of which they get a refund. And on top of that, we also recently found out the 2013 Yahoo breach compromised the personal data, it's hard to believe, 3 billion users. That's the biggest data breach in history. And yet today, here we are once again dealing in the aftermath of the recent Equifax breach involving the personal identification information of nearly 145 million Americans. Now, this most recent breach raises an even more troubling question. Because if credit reporting agencies that offer identity theft protection and credit monitoring services can't even safeguard their own data from hackers, then how can consumers trust any company to protect their information? And let me say also, when you get up against the sophistication of state actors, such as Russia and China, it's going to be hard to protect against them. So sadly, the question that millions of Americans are now asking is, as they struggle to figure out how to protect themselves in the wake of these massive breaches, what in the world do we do? So this committee, Mr. Chairman, is going to again consider what it would do to make sure that consumers are protected. But if we're going to do anything meaningful, we must have the political will to hold these companies accountable. Over the years, the Federal Trade Commission has brought numerous enforcement actions against companies for lax data security practices. But industry has recently challenged the FTC's well-established legal authority to bring such actions. Furthermore, this piecemeal, after-the-fact approach would be better served if the FTC were able to prescribe rules that require companies to adopt reasonable security practices in the first place. The FTC has already put forward rules that apply to financial institutions like Equifax. The agency should have a similar authority for the rest of the commercial sector. And so, Mr. Chairman, I think at the end of the day, it's only stiffer enforcement and stringent penalties are going to be able to help incentivize companies to properly safeguard their consumer information and to notify their consumers when they've been compromised. I strongly believe that without rigorous data security rules in place, it is not a question of if that we will have another one, but when. So we can either take action with common sense rules, or we can start planning for our next hearing on this issue. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Nelson. And I too hope that the hearing today can inform our future actions. It's an issue that I think needs to be addressed, and Congress needs to be heard from. So glad to have our panel with us this morning. On my left and your right is Mr. Paulino Barros, Jr., who's the Interim Chief Executive Officer at Equifax. Next to him is Mr. Richard Smith, who's the former CEO at Equifax. Ms. Marissa Mayer, who is the former CEO at Yahoo, Incorporated. Ms. Karen Zachariah, who's the Deputy General Counsel and Chief Privacy Officer for Verizon Communications, the parent company of Yahoo since 2017. And Mr. Todd Wilkinson, who's President and Chief Executive Officer of Entrust Data Card Corporation. So we'll ask you to proceed with your comments. I'll start on my left with you, Mr. Barros, and ask if you can to confine your oral remarks as close to 5 minutes as possible, but anything that you want to add will be included in the written record of the hearing. So thank you for being here, Mr. Barros.
Good morning, Chairman Thune, Ranking Member Nelson, members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to be here today. My name is Paulino Dorrego Barros, Jr. 6 weeks ago, I was named Interim Chief Executive Officer of Equifax. I never expected to become CEO in these circumstances, but I'm honored to be in this position. Speaking for everyone at Equifax, I'm determined to address all the issues from the data breach that we can regain the confidence of the American people. Although Equifax is based in Atlanta, I think you can tell from my accent that I did not grow up in Georgia. I'm a native of Brazil. I have had the privilege of working most of my adult life in the U.S. My children were born here. I'm an engineer by training, and I have spent a lifetime confronting and fixing complex business problems. This is the mindset I bring to my new position. My first act as CEO was to immediately address our consumer response in the call centers and our website. Our engagement with consumers was not acceptable, and we are working hard to fix the problems. I also apologize to the American people, and I do so again here today. What I promise each of you and the American people is that Equifax will be focused every day on strengthening security and providing better support for consumers. We'll be an industry leader in giving consumers more control over personal credit data. In advance of your questions, I would like to review briefly some of the actions we have taken in the past 6 weeks. First, my highest priority has been to improve service for consumers. To this end, I have visited call centers, I have spoken with call center reps, I have personally taken calls from consumers, and I have helped resolve their issues. Through social media, we have expanded communication with consumers. Most significantly, we have improved the website, added staff to the call centers, and made the overall experience more consumer-friendly. The result is a substantial reduction in delays and backlogs. Second, we have revised our corporate structure. The Chief Security Officer now reports directly to me. I have also appointed a Chief Transformation Officer to oversee the company's response to the cybersecurity incident. Third, we are rapidly improving our security infrastructure. We are further hardening our networks, changing our patching procedures, introducing new vulnerability detection tools, and strengthening our accountability mechanisms. Fourth, we have committed to working with the entire industry to develop solutions to the growing cybersecurity and data protection challenges we all face. And finally, we promise to launch a new, easy-to-use app in January that will give consumers the power to lock and unlock access to personal credit data for free and for life. I'm pleased to report that we are on schedule with the development of the app, and we are confident consumers will find it extremely valuable. We have done a lot in a short period of time, but this is just the beginning. I remind my team every day that there are no shortcuts. Strengthening the company's security capabilities and serving consumers requires both a daily engagement and a long-term commitment. And I pledge this is now how we will continue to proceed. Equifax is made up of 10,000 talented and dedicated people. Our business is not well understood, but is essential for the economy and is for helping consumers obtain credit they need. Our top job must be to protect the data entrusted to us. We did not meet the public expectations, and now it's up to us to prove that we can regain the trust. We are committed to working with consumers, customers, Congress, and the regulators to remedy these issues and restore public trust. This has been my focus during my first 6 weeks as CEO, and will continue to be my focus every day I'm in this job. Thank you for your attention, and I welcome your questions.
Thank you, Mr. Barrels. Mr. Smith.
Thank you. Thank you, Chairman Thune, Ranking Member Nelson, and the honorable members of the committee. Thank you for the opportunity to testify before you today. I have submitted my written testimony to this committee, as well as to a number of other committees, in both the Senate and the House, that I've testified before over the past 3 or 4 weeks. That written testimony is the record of the events of the breach at Equifax occurred. And I'm here today, Mr. Chairman, to answer any questions you may have. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Smith. Ms. Mayor.
Chairman Thune, Ranking Member Nelson, and distinguished members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to appear before you today. I had the honor and privilege of serving as Yahoo's Chief Executive Officer from July 2012 through the sale of its core operating business in June of this year. As you know, Yahoo was the victim of criminal state-sponsored attacks on its systems, resulting in the theft of certain user information. We worked hard over the years to earn our users' trust. As CEO, these thefts occurred during my tenure, and I want to sincerely apologize to each and every one of our users. When Yahoo learned of a state-sponsored attack on its systems in late 2014, Yahoo promptly reported it to law enforcement and notified the users understood at that time to have been directly impacted. Yahoo worked closely with law enforcement, including the FBI, who were ultimately able to identify and expose the hackers responsible for these attacks. We now know that Russian intelligence officers and state-sponsored hackers were responsible for highly complex and sophisticated attacks on Yahoo systems. The Department of Justice and FBI announced a 47-count indictment charging four individuals with these crimes against Yahoo and its users. The DOJ and FBI praised Yahoo for our extensive cooperation and early proactive engagement with law enforcement. In November 2016, law enforcement provided Yahoo with data files that a third party claimed contained Yahoo user data. Yahoo determined that user data was most likely stolen from the company in August of 2013. Although Yahoo and its outside forensic experts were unable to identify the intrusion associated with the August 2013 theft, the company promptly disclosed the incident, notified the users believed to have been affected, and took steps to secure all user accounts. I want to stress how seriously I view the threat of cyber attacks and how personally I feel about these potential risks. After growing up in Wisconsin, I remember buying my first computer in college, developing a passion for computer science and writing code, and seeing the potential for how this emerging technology could change the world. After college, I was hired by a small startup named Google as their 20th employee and first woman engineer. There, over the next 13 years, I worked my way up from software engineer to ultimately becoming a member of the executive operating committee. In July of 2012, I became the CEO of Yahoo. I will always be grateful for and humbled by the opportunity to have led Yahoo and its employees for the last 5 years. My experiences from Yahoo and Google have shown me the amazing potential of the internet to change our world for the better. They, however, have also reinforced the potential dangers posed by cybercrime. I'm here today to discuss with the committee, as best I am able, our efforts to confront the challenges of cybersecurity, including some of the security measures and defenses Yahoo had in place in the hopes of further advancing consumer protection and security. Throughout my tenure as CEO, we worked hard from the top down and bottom up to protect our systems and our users. We devoted substantial resources to security with the shared goal of staying ahead of these sophisticated and constantly evolving threats. After I joined Yahoo, we roughly doubled our internal security staff and made significant investments in its leadership and the team. In addition to improving our talent, we also improved our security processes and system defenses. Yahoo had in place multiple layers of sophisticated protection. During my tenure at Yahoo, we were extremely committed to security and invested tremendous resources. I want to thank all of our team members for their tireless efforts in addressing Yahoo's security. Unfortunately, while all of our measures helped Yahoo successfully defend against the barrage of attacks by both private and state-sponsored hackers, Russian agents intruded on our systems. The threat from state-sponsored attacks has changed the playing field so dramatically that today, I believe all companies, even the most well-defended ones, could fall victim to these crimes. I will close by saying that cybersecurity is a global challenge. As we have all witnessed, no company, individual, or even government agency is immune from these threats. The attacks on Yahoo demonstrate that strong collaboration between the public and private sectors is essential in the fight against cybercrime. In addition, aggressive pursuit of cyber criminals, as the DOJ and FBI exhibited in Yahoo's case, could be a meaningful deterrent in preventing future crimes like these. To echo the words of the then Acting Assistant Attorney General overseeing the investigation of the cybercrime perpetrated against Yahoo, a nation-state attack is not a fair fight, and it is not a fight you will win alone. By working together, we can help to level the cyber playing field. Thank you for the opportunity to address the committee today.
Thank you, Ms. Mayor. Ms. Zachariah.
Chairman Thune, Ranking Member Nelson, and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to testify here today. My name is Karen Zachariah, and I am Verizon's Chief Privacy Officer. Verizon has a significant and longstanding commitment to protecting and safeguarding consumer data and building trust online. In an increasingly connected world, Verizon recognizes that strong security and consumer trust are prerequisites to compete in the 21st century digital economy. The very nature of our business has always required that Verizon make data security a top priority. On July 25, 2016, Verizon announced that it had entered into an agreement to acquire Yahoo's operating business. That acquisition closed on June 13, 2017. Yahoo is now part of a new company formed by Verizon called Oath. Oath consists of more than 50 digital and mobile brands globally, including HuffPost, Yahoo News, Yahoo Sports, Tumblr, and AOL. In September and December of 2016, Yahoo announced that certain user data was stolen in two separate incidents in 2013 and 2014. These incidents happened well before Verizon's acquisition of Yahoo. At the time of the December 2016 announcement, Yahoo disclosed that more than 1 billion of the approximately 3 billion accounts existing in 2013 had likely been impacted. After Verizon acquired Yahoo, we obtained new information from a third party and reviewed it with the assistance of the same outside forensic experts that Yahoo had used previously. Based on that review, we concluded that all accounts, and not just a subset, were impacted by the 2013 security incident. Yahoo then provided further individual notices to the impacted users beginning on October 3, 2017, less than a week after we determined the scope of the impacted user accounts. In addition, the review confirmed that the stolen information did not include Social Security numbers. It also did not include passwords in clear text, and it did not include sensitive financial information like payment card data or bank account information. Although Verizon did not own Yahoo's operating business at the time of the 2013 data theft or during Yahoo's incident response, we understood that Yahoo took actions around the time of its announcements to protect its users' accounts. Yahoo required password changes for user accounts where passwords had not been changed since 2014. Yahoo also invalidated unencrypted security questions and answers so that they could not be used to access an account. Yahoo took these actions on user accounts beyond those thought to have been impacted by the security incidents. This means that Yahoo took steps in 2016 to protect all users, including the additional user accounts that were individually notified in October 2017. Proactively enhancing our security is a top priority at Verizon and Oath. We carefully track the evolution of attacks, gather intelligence, leverage technology advances to make improvements to our systems, and to apply more advanced protection to our user accounts. As part of integrating Yahoo and AOL into Oath, we are combining two strong existing security teams. We are examining the practices and tools of each team and applying the best practices and tools across Oath. We are also in the process of creating an advisory board that will consist of external security experts. The board will provide input to Oath on its overall approach to security. Security has always been in Verizon's DNA, and we remain committed to continuous improvement to meet the security challenges of the future. At Verizon and Oath, we are laser focused on the needs of our customers. We know that they expect that their information will be secure. As a result, we go to great lengths to integrate security across our networks, platforms, and products. We are committing substantial resources to defend our company's assets, networks, and customers, including those acquired with the closing of the Yahoo transaction. With the benefit of Verizon's experience and resources, along with a commitment to the highest level of accountability, Verizon and Oath will continue to strive to stay ahead of an ever-evolving threat landscape. Thank you again for the opportunity to testify today. I look forward to answering your questions.
Thanks, Ms. Zachariah. Mr. Wilkinson.
Chairman Thune, Ranking Member Nelson, and members of the committee, thank you for the opportunity to discuss the recent major data breaches that have touched the vast majority of American consumers and the urgent actions necessary to protect sensitive personal information. For almost 50 years, Entrust Data Card has provided solutions that enable the creation of secure physical and digital identities and that are used around the world in banking, government, and enterprise applications. Identity is a foundational element of our commerce system and the way Americans build their financial lives. The value of identity is the primary reason this information is targeted and why we continue to see more sophisticated attacks that lead to significant data breaches. We live in an incredibly connected and complex world. The challenge of protecting data is an evolving and sophisticated task, but it starts with a secure identity. This will only become more critical as we continue to drive toward greater connectivity, linking virtually every aspect of our lives to a connected system. According to the 2017 Verizon Data Breach Investigations Report, 43% of all data breaches can be traced to a phishing attack in which a malicious actor was able to compromise an identity and use this information to gain access to data. Once compromised, a primary target is consumer identities. The information stolen in the most recent breaches contained a significant amount of personally identifiable information, or PII, belonging to millions of American citizens. The focus of this hearing is to examine the recent data breach events, identify steps that could have been taken to ensure the safety of consumer data, and to determine if there are options to further safeguard consumer identities in the future. Regarding the issue of steps that can be taken to better ensure the safety of consumer data, today organizations are challenged by increasingly complex systems and a rise in attacks from nation states and other well-organized groups. This committee can bring forward a number of experts, and most will agree that no system is free from vulnerabilities and all have the potential to be breached. However, there are documented best practices and numerous security tools available to mitigate common attacks, and the vast majority of major breaches are still the result of common security mistakes and stolen credentials resulting from poor cyber hygiene. Today, a substantial amount of PII, that is the basis of our identities used for secure transactions, has already been stolen and can potentially be used to defraud consumers. It is essential to now find a balance between driving responsible behavior in enterprise security and providing an answer to the underlying security of consumer identities. To address consumer identity, it will be critical to implement a resilient identity system that can respond to compromise with the ability to recover quickly and to ensure consumer data is no longer at risk. Today, the federal government provides a 9-digit number issued on a paper card, our Social Security card. This static number is generally issued at birth and difficult to change without significant inconvenience to the citizen. While we have made substantial advances in technology, this foundational form of identification has not changed, leaving consumers vulnerable to compromise. Our recommendation to this committee is that the time is upon us to create a new identity framework. This new framework would create a modern secure identity through a collaboration of government and industry. There are several examples of public-private partnerships around the world delivering stronger identity frameworks as a foundation for commerce. A new identity framework will allow citizens to utilize a more secure method to transact and to do so in a manner that reduces the potential of breach or compromise. In all use cases, this new identity framework could minimize risk and inconvenience to the consumer in cases of breach and allow a consumer to more easily recover their identity with minimal impact. Our identity system today is broken. It is not secure. It is time to leverage available technologies to provide Americans with new mechanisms to protect their identities. In my company's previous testimony, we've recommended the best path forward rests upon a public-private ecosystem that's built upon good security governance, secure identities, and constant self-assessment of vulnerabilities. Whether we drive adoption via incentive or directive, we need to proceed now. I urge you to focus on near-term actions to address the consumer information that has already been compromised while working toward longer-term solutions which create a more resilient identity for American consumers. Chairperson Thune, committee members, fellow panelists, thank you for your time today.
Thank you, Mr. Wilkinson. I'm going to start with the questions and start, Ms. Mayor. In your opening statement, you described the significant investments that Yahoo made under your leadership with respect to its internal security. Nevertheless, despite these investments, the company apparently failed to detect the 2013 breach, which was the largest breach in the history of the Internet, for more than 3 years. And even after the 2013 breach became apparent, Yahoo significantly underestimated the number of accounts implicated by billions. And so I'll give you an opportunity to answer the obvious question, but that is, with such a strong security team in place, how did Yahoo fail to recognize that all 3 billion of its user accounts had been compromised, and why did it take more than 3 years to discover and to disclose the breach?
At Yahoo, we deeply valued our users' security and invested heavily in that security. As is frequently the case in these types of cyber attacks, they are complex, they are persistent, and in often cases, the understanding of the facts evolves over time. To this day, we, as I understand it, still have not been able to identify the intrusion that led to that theft, which is to say we have received files from law enforcement that contained Yahoo data, and we verified that it came from Yahoo, but we don't exactly understand how the act was perpetrated. And that certainly led to some of the areas where we had gaps in information.
Why the delay in disclosing it? I mean, it took from 2013 3 years to, and why, how was it possible to underestimate by billions, literally, the number of consumers who were impacted by it?
Yahoo did not know of the intrusion in 2013. We learned of the intrusion by files that were presented to us in November of 2016. And in a very short period of time, we verified that that data was taken from Yahoo, that it was most likely from August of 2013, notified law enforcement, notified our users, and took protective actions on all the accounts. And at that time, we estimated that it affected more than 1 billion users. There have been recent announcements from Verizon that I'm not privy to since I'm no longer with the company.
So the $500 million that was originally disclosed and then it jumped up to $3 billion, there's no real explanation, at least to your knowledge, for how you miscalculated the number of people impacted?
The $500 million number was related to the fall 2014 breach by the Russian hackers, where the indictments were issued by the DOJ and FBI.
Mr. Smith, in prior testimony before Congress, you said that the failure to patch a known vulnerability in your system basically boiled down to a single employee's failure to act, compounded by an IT scan that should have detected that failure but didn't. Then to add insult to injury, the vulnerability was allowed to persist for several months without corrective action being taken. So for a company that holds some of the most sensitive personal information on millions of American consumers, I hope you can understand why this revelation is so hard to understand. Can you explain why there weren't more tripwires or redundancies built into your system to prevent something like this from happening? You've also testified that these weaknesses have now been addressed, and perhaps you could also elaborate on how.
Yes, Mr. Chairman, you're right. In prior testimonies, I referred to the fact that we were notified by U.S. CERT in March of this year, March 8th of this year, communicated per our protocol on the 9th to patch the vulnerability in the Strut software, open source software that existed. That email did go out per our protocol. On the 15th of March, we then scanned, and the scanner did not find the vulnerability. So we had a human error, as I described in the past, as well as a technology error. Both led to the ability for the criminals to access what we call our web portal dispute environment.
But why would you have had more redundancies built into your system? Why was it just basically comes down to, you know, one employee? That seems really hard to fathom.
Yeah, clarification.
A company that specializes in what you do.
Yeah, the redundancy was the scanner, and the scanner did not work as well. So you had the human process of, which is standard process of identifying a patch, the vulnerability, applying the patch, and then going back a week later with a technology scanner to see if the patch was applied.
And can you said you've fix that, or you can elaborate a little bit on that. Maybe Mr. Barros as well could elaborate on any further steps that Equifax has taken since the breach.
I'll start, and Mr. Barros can continue, if you will. What we had installed shortly after, about the time of one of my last hearings, was a new scanning technology. We upgraded a scanning technology to a new generation scanner that is seems to be a better scanner than the prior scanner. There's some process changes, Paul, you may want to talk about as well.
Sure. As you can imagine, this has been my top priority, strengthening security systems in our company. We have done a comprehensive top-down review of the process with the help of PwC and Mandiant, and we are strengthening all aspects of our operations, including our patching capabilities, enhancing and updating our tools to make sure that we have a effective detection system in place. We have actually put stronger policies in place, you know, to make sure that we have more redundancy and closed loops in order to make sure that our actions are be executive with accuracy.
Have you disposed of the data that you no longer need? Has Equifax disposed of?
This is part of the process that we're going through right now. We're evaluating the data architecture that we have to have in place.
How about encrypted?
Whatever is necessary to do it, including encryption, including tokenization, including all new technologies available to make sure that we protect the data. Okay. In both, in the data itself, and the architecture that the data is going to be displaced.
Okay, thank Senator Nelson.
Ladies and gentlemen, we've had these hearings before, and if we don't do something, we're going to be having a lot of these hearings again. At this point, I'm wondering that there's no such thing as data security. When you think of a sophisticated state actor, such as China or Russia, your companies can't stand up against them. The only person or institution that can stand up against them is the National Security Agency. And what we're going to see in the future for not only personally identifiable information, but the state secrets of our country, many of which are critical infrastructure as represented by companies such as yours, there's going to have to be a cooperation between the most sophisticated player in the United States, which is the NSA, and you all. Otherwise, we Americans are not going to have any more privacy. And if we don't do something, and if you all don't do something to change this, we're going to be right back here on additional hearings coming up on this same topic. Now, Ms. Mayor, what do you think? You had a sophisticated state actor coming after you. What do you, how do you really think that you could have protected yourself?
Even robust defenses and processes are not sufficient to protect against a state-sponsored attack, especially one that's extremely sophisticated and persistent. We at Yahoo cooperated with law enforcement and brought these breaches and intrusions to the attention of law enforcement swiftly each time they were detected. And the DOJ and FBI were of great assistance to the company in identifying the perpetrators and bringing them to justice.
But that's an admission that you're not protected against a state actor. So now, Ms. Zachariah, you all own Yahoo. What are you all going to do about it?
Thank you, Senator. A couple of different things. First, your point that we have to work together is absolutely right. I think we need to work both with industry and with government to try to tackle this problem. And that's true in a number of different areas. Verizon, for example, has long believed that there should be national data security and data breach legislation, and we would be happy to work with any of the senators here on what that legislation should look like. In addition, though, all of our security teams need to understand that security isn't static, it's always changing. The attackers are getting better, the tools are getting better, the intelligence that we're gathering is changing, and so as that's happening, we have to make sure that we're changing our security systems to improve and keep up.
That's a good intention, but it's going to take more. It's going to take an attitude change among companies such as yours that we've got to go to extreme limits to protect our customers' privacy. So, Mr. Smith, you all, you know, you hold a lot of a financial guillotine over a lot of your customers by virtue of what their credit rating is. And so if your data is not protected, the poor little fella goes to buy a house, and he's got it ready, and he's got the down payment, and then he can't get a mortgage because now he's got something, a black mark on his credit rating that is not real but has been placed there because of a data breach. And the poor little fella can't close on his house. This has huge consequences. What are you and Mr. Barrios going to do about it?
Mr. Senator, there's no doubt that securing data is the core value of our company. And I will also, like Mr. Barrios said, apologize deeply to the American public for the breach that we had. We let the public down. I'll tell you this. I do agree with the other panelists here and your point earlier, Mr. Senator, a combination cooperation between public-private to address this issue is needed. In my 12 years of running the company and tracking the velocity, the increase of cyber attacks is remarkable to see. In prior testimonies, I talked about it's not unusual for us in any one given year to see suspicious activity, unwanted attempted attacks of millions per year.
Okay, but Mr. Smith, didn't you describe Equifax as the victim when the company failed to secure the security vulnerability that led to the breach? Is Equifax really the victim?
I believe I described ourselves as we're a victim of a criminal attack.
Mr. Wilkinson, do you consider Equifax to be a victim?
Senator, I think they're a victim, as my fellow panelists pointed out. Certainly, there's been many victims in the cases of these breaches. But the criminal impact from hackers moving into these enterprises creates them to also be positioned to be a victim, in my opinion.
Well, do you believe that they had adequate security measures in place?
Based on my understanding of the breach that occurred at Equifax, and we're talking about effectively patching of security vulnerabilities in a timely way, we've heard some discussion of some of the increase in security stance that they've had since the breach. These are the types of things that I would suggest to you are basically under standard best practices. Most security.
I don't understand your question. Do you consider them to have had appropriate security protocols?
Having not patched for as long as they did, I would not recommend suggesting that was the adequate security protocol.
Okay, so the answer is no.
No.
So Equifax is not the victim, it's the poor customers of Equifax. Is that correct?
I believe both are victims, Senator, in my opinion.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Nelson. Senator Wicker.
Mr. Smith, in your written testimony, one of your suggestions is a public-private partnership to begin a dialogue on replacing social security numbers as methods of verification. I wonder if that also, if your suggestion would also apply to rethinking the use of passwords and user ID numbers. And I'm going to ask Mr. Wilkinson to address this question also, because in your testimony, Mr. Wilkinson, you talk about dynamic identities as a way to replace the social security number in the modern age. And you point to Brazil as a better example, where the government owns core identity issuing technology and issues some sort of digital identity that might last for 3 years. So I'll go to Mr. Wilkinson first, and then back to Mr. Smith. Is that system working better for the consumer in Brazil, or is it just a helpful aspect but still doesn't get the job done against this onslaught which Senator Nelson described in his question?
Thank you for the question, Senator. There were two questions. The beginning, in your first question, you asked a question about the use of passwords and identifiers, as well as a social security number. With static information, like username, password, or social security number, you have a generally weak identity framework, which is why we talk about the need for additional security. Now, there's many tools today that many companies are using around secure authentication that help overcome some of the vulnerabilities that we see from things like username passwords. Some of those tools need to be deployed as we talk about where we use social security numbers as a primary form of our identification that forms the basis of our identity. In my written testimony, I also provided some additional examples of what we see other countries doing that I won't suggest to you are best practices, but I would suggest would be important for this committee to look at. In some cases, these countries have moved to digital identity systems, in part because they didn't have anything in place. What our recommendation is, of course, we're moving from a system that's worked in the United States for probably 50 years, but no longer is secure. The example that you cite from Brazil is a form of digital identity that is issued by the federal government for the purpose of providing a citizen with a digital identity that they can use for certain transactions, high security needs, digital signing requirements, and has limited life, in that case, 3 to 5 years. So the combination of the way that they have deployed that identity framework is more secure and provides the ability to be more resilient than what we see today and what we're able to recover from in the event of a breach like what we just talked about from Equifax.
In your view, the consumer is better protected under this Brazilian system?
They can be, yes.
Mr. Smith, what do you say?
I'd agree. Not much I can add to that, but the concept of using a static 1936 instrument like the SSN is, and thinking it's secure, we've outlived that concept. Some combination of digital multi-factor authentication, as Mr. Wilkerson talked about, I think is the right path.
Ms. Zachariah, you suggest legislation, and it might be that all five members of the panel are advocating legislation. We only have a minute 23 left, but in general, what would this legislation look like?
I think the two key things that should be in data breach legislation are, number one, that it be a national framework so that we have one standard to comply with as we're responding to a data breach. And number two, it's really important that it get the standard right for when we notify customers. It's important to notify customers about information that they really need, but to make sure that we're not notifying them so often and about so many things that they stop paying attention.
And would anyone like to take issue with Senator Nelson's overall conclusion that really against a state actor, like we've seen, a mere company is just unable to withstand that without going to NSA? Anybody want to disagree with that? No takers. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Wicker. Senator Blumenthal.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for having this hearing. Thank you to the witnesses for being here today. I think almost every American consumer at this point is aware of the unacceptable risks that right now are entailed in many of our business practices, risks to their privacy. Information that they expect and reasonably anticipate will be safeguarded by companies that do business with them and where they are customers. The Equifax breach in particular exposed the limits of the Federal Trade Commission's ability to protect consumers and impose civil penalties on companies that treat our data with negligence and recklessness. Under current law, even some of the most egregious examples of lax security can be met only with apologies and promises to do better next time, not fines or other penalties or real deterrence that provide incentives to business executives to actually do better. The real deterrent will come when those penalties are imposed on executives like the ones before us today. And if the entities that hold our data cannot be trusted to protect it, then the government needs to have the tools to not only go after hackers and thieves, but also hold companies accountable. Common sense legislation I've introduced, the Data Breach Accountability and Enforcement Act of 2017, would ensure that the FTC can investigate any data breach by any company or organization that holds sensitive consumer data, including nonprofits, and can impose civil penalties that are actually sufficiently strong to motivate companies to implement strong security at the onset in this area, truly, an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. In fact, in many instances, for many consumers, there is no real cure. When you were here last, I think it was the last time you are on the Senate side, at least, you came before the Judiciary Committee, Mr. Smith, and I asked you whether you could commit that none of your consumers would ever be required to go through arbitration. You said, understandably, that you were no longer with the company, and therefore you couldn't guarantee. So I'm going to ask Mr. Barros, and I appreciate your being here today. I have the same question. Can you guarantee that no consumer will be required to go through arbitration if they decide to use one of your services or products?
Senator, I understand the issue relative to the arbitration on the first product when it came out and was immediately removed. Arbitration is a tool used by the industry, especially the consumer industry. We have used that tool in the light of the law. We'll continue to evolve in this process and examine the use of this arbitration process.
And I apologize for interrupting you, but my time is limited, as you understand.
Totally.
So this is one of those yes or no answers, I think. Can you guarantee that you won't use arbitration? I understand all of the, on the one hand, on the other hand, comments that could be made, but consumers expect that they will have a right to go to court and have their rights vindicated there. Can you guarantee that you will not force them to use arbitration?
I believe the consumers have a choice to choose the products that they need.
But if they choose your products, they will not be forced to arbitration. You're guaranteeing that?
We work according to the law and use the tools that the industry uses to have arbitration in place.
You know the difference between a credit freeze and a credit lock?
Yes, I know.
Can you guarantee that the credit lock, if you use them, will be subject to consumer protection under the state laws where consumers live?
The way I understand we use freeze and lock is that at the end of the day, for the consumer, it provides the same result. The state law requires the different regulated process for you to obtain the freeze.
The difference is credit freezes are regulated by states.
Correct.
Credit locks are not. You're resorting to credit locks. Is it to avoid state oversight?
No.
And scrutiny?
I'm sorry. No, not at all. We did it because it's simple to use, it's more accessible to use, it's easy to understand by the consumer.
My time has expired. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I hope we'll have a second round.
Thank you, Senator Blumenthal. Senator Schatz.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. Barros, thank you for being here. Do you think consumers should be able to see the same information that their bank uses when the bank makes a credit decision?
Come on. We have, as an industry, not done a good job representing to the consumer how we play in this process. The information is provided by the consumer when he's in the process of acquiring a new car, getting open a credit card. This information is turned into a financial institution.
Right, I understand how it works. I'm just saying that when the bank evaluates my creditworthiness, they get a bunch of data. I don't get to see what they're looking at. Do you think I should be able to see what they're looking at when evaluating my creditworthiness?
You.
This is also probably a yes or no answer.
You have access to your credit report. You have access to your score. This is the information that they use to make, most of the time they use to make a decision.
So it's the same information?
This a credit report is the same as I have. The same, my score is the same as I have. So it's the same information they use to make a decision. They are allowed to see the information.
You're telling me that the information that a so-called customer has is all that a bank is provided by Equifax?
I don't know. I don't know what the bank could provide the information. I know what I provide to the bank.
Yeah, well, Mr. Smith, you sounded like you wanted to correct
something. No, just if I may add something to it for clarification. If a consumer is going to a bank to apply for a loan of some sort, typically the underwriter at the bank would pull a credit file, either ours, T, or Experian. The consumer has the right to get access to that free every year themselves. They also have access to the score, as Mr. Barrow said. I think what you're referring to is the banks don't just use a standard score like a FICO score. They may have their own score, and that score is not disclosable to the individual consumer.
Okay. Are we your customers? Are people the people whose data was breached, are we your customers, or the lenders your customers? How do you see that?
Well, we have customers as consumers, a small part of our business consumers. Most of the customers that I have would be institutions that have consumers as customers.
Okay, because it seems to me that there's actually a line on this, on that side of the dais, which is to say, not to excuse what happened with Yahoo, but it is different. The incentives are different between the credit reporting agencies who have essentially zero financial incentive to get it right. You guys get informed by the Department of Homeland Security that there's a vulnerability. You get provided the patch. You don't download the patch. Your scanner doesn't work. Executives cash out their stock. You then start charging people to lock their credit or freeze their credit. You then start to promote through LifeLock. You have commercials with LifeLock saying, hey, there's been a breach. You might want to use this product. LifeLock subcontracts to Equifax. You guys continue to be profitable. On the other side, for Verizon, for Yahoo, for Google, for other companies, if you screw up with your customers, there is a customer relationship that is frayed. But in the case of the credit reporting agencies, there is no volition on the side of the customers. And that's the foundational problem here, which is that there is no incentive on your side to do anything other than to charge us to solve the problem that you caused. There is no incentive on your side to spend the money that it would take to transform the company to actually treat us like customers, because your customers are lenders. Your customers are not the people who got harmed through the breach. Mr. Barros, do you want to respond to that?
I think that the biggest incentive that we have is the stewardship that we have, the obligation that we have with the consumer to keep their data accurate and safe.
Right, but that's not a fiduciary. I mean, you have an earnings call, I think, tomorrow or shortly, and you're going to report, presumably, that everything's fine or that things are starting to pick up, or maybe even, I don't know, maybe even that you made more profit than usual in the wake of this problem. And I would be remiss if I didn't mention, because people back home, and I don't mean just back home where I live, but back home where all of us live, cannot understand how the CEO of Equifax and the CEO of Yahoo walked away with $90 million and $27 million and possibly $250 million in stocks. This is unfathomable to the average person. And I understand, Mr. Smith, you and I had an exchange in the banking committee where you said this was in the proxy, it's set by the board, it's not under my control. I understand all of that. What I'm saying is regular people don't understand that, and they shouldn't understand how you harm consumers and then walk away with the amount of money that a small city or county uses for their annual operating budget. It's not fair, and it's why this dais has an obligation to make a law and not just drag you back and forth and wave our fingers at you. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Schott. Senator Moran.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank the ranking member. Let me start by asking this question. Let me set the premise, perhaps first to Mr. Smith and Mr. Barros, and then Ms. Mayer and Ms. Zachariah. So a business makes a calculation. It determines probabilities, and it makes a decision about how it invests, in this case, invests in its data security based upon the probabilities of events happening. And so my question is, before the breaches occurred at initially Equifax and with both companies, before those breaches occurred, what did you expect? What did you say to your executive committee or to your board of directors? What's the probability of a breach occurring at our company? And then the follow-up question to that is, and what's that probability today?
So you calculated what the probabilities were. You make investment decisions about how to invest in security. And what that probability is it any different today for an additional breach at either one of your companies than it was prior to the original breaches? Mr. Smith?
Thank you, Senator. I'd put it in a framework like this. We don't calculate the actual percentage probability. We've got a very comprehensive framework called Enterprise Risk Management. I'm sure you've heard of that, ERM. And for 10 years or so, we've always ranked data security as the most high risk, high probability risk we have as a company. If we had a cybersecurity event, it would be detrimental to the company. We don't calculate it, is it 50%, 60%, 10%, or 5%. But
Does that statement mean that you would expect a breach?
The probability of a breach
is
in a
high.
Data, yes.
Okay. And is that calculation any different today, Mr. Barros, based upon the changes that you've made at the company? Is it still the same probability of a breach occurring today or tomorrow as it was prior to the earlier breaches?
Well, we believe that today we are better than we were at the time of the breach for one reason. This was a pivoting point in our industry. We had to, in our company, essentially, you have to make significant investments. You continue to do so to make sure that it's better today and it will be better tomorrow.
So how much more money are you spending today to prevent a breach from happening than you were spending as a company prior to the earlier breach?
As a natural response to the incident, we're spending significant more money in that process.
But what percentage increase at your company has occurred as a result of what you learned from the breaches that have occurred in the past?
We're expecting to have a specific spike on the cost for the.
You spend 50% more today than you did before? Or
easily.
75, 100, yeah. 100, 200% more?
Four times more.
Four times more?
Yeah.
And as a result of spending four times more, would you say it's less likely today that a breach occurs at your company than the probability of it occurring before?
This is my understanding.
And what would be your reduction in that? What's the reduction in the probability?
I don't have a specific number because we have a series of actions taking place today. I can say today that we believe that it's better today than it was before.
Would it be better if you were spending, instead of four times more, six times more? Is the technology out there that you could acquire to prevent this from happening?
We are acquiring technology, new tools, you know, to make sure that it happens. We've been advised by specialists to make sure that we have a sequence of installing this technology. There's a timing to do it.
Would Yahoo answer this question in its circumstances?
We have at Yahoo one of the most valuable databases in the world just because of the sheer number of users that are contained therein. We describe this as an arms race. Hackers become ever more sophisticated, and we have to become sophisticated in turn. So
would you have predicted a breach before it occurred? Would you expect a breach? I assume the answer to that's no, or you would have been doing something more?
We did not calculate percentages and or predict a breach. I will say we took significant efforts and investment to increase our security, which included increasing the size of the team by a factor of two. We did things like empowering our users to opt out of passwords and into something called Yahoo Account Key. We increased our encryption, constantly changing the types of encryption we used to thwart hackers. We introduced a bug bounty where outside developers, if they discovered a vulnerability, could report it, and we would reward them. We hired outside teams to attack us and tell us where our vulnerabilities were. We introduced machine learning to monitor our system and evolve with the hackers to ultimately identify when intrusions occurred. So we took extensive actions.
Let me turn to Ms. Zachariah. Is the probability of a breach less today at Yahoo than it was prior to your acquisition of the company?
So again, we don't calculate the probability of a breach, but what we do is
let me ask the question differently then. Are customers more secure today than they were prior to the breach? Can a customer expect that it will have less expectation that their data is at risk than before the earlier breach?
What I can tell you, Senator, is that Verizon has always taken privacy security very seriously, and we're bringing that same focus and that same intensity that we've always brought to protecting our customers and our network to any new acquisition, including Yahoo.
What seems to be missing to me, the assurance that as a customer, however we define customer, should have a sense that they're safer today than they were before, and I don't have any assurance from any of the response to my questions that that's the case, that we ought to be just as concerned today about a breach as prior to. And, you know, what I hear is that we're taking all these steps. Let me ask you this question. Do you believe that other companies in the similar business, the companies that have lots of data that would affect consumers if there was a breach, are they as vulnerable to breaches as your companies are and have been? This is not limited to Yahoo. It's not limited to Equifax. Every other company that's in the data business is just as vulnerable as you have been and are today?
I would point out that the list of efforts that I discussed earlier were our ongoing defenses. In addition, in response to the breach, we took significant steps, causing our users to reset their passwords, changing our encryption, changing the attack surface area of our systems, and the access that even internal employees had to those systems. So by all means, we did respond and change the level of protection that we're
giving. And therefore,
today,
as a customer of Yahoo's, I should feel how much better that my data is safe.
I think it's difficult to quantify, but there's no question that, in my mind, that the users are better protected today because these breaches were detected and remediated for.
Are you spending all the money necessary to increase that protection? Could they be safer if you did more? Or are you doing everything you can do?
I am no longer with the company, but I would say that certainly during my tenure that was the case.
Ms. Zachariah?
Yeah, and the security, exactly right, I agree. The security teams at Verizon would tell you that their job is to defend against any and all attacker, and that's exactly what we're trying to do.
And the company provides them with the resources to accomplish that goal?
Absolutely.
Mr. Barros?
Same for us.
And final question is, do any of you disagree that the Federal Trade Commission has jurisdiction over your data breaches and has the ability to regulate and to penalize for faults, to prevent and then to penalize if there are breaches? You all agree that FTC is your regulator and has legal authority?
Unfortunately.
Did you say unfortunately?
I said that they make sure the regulatory perspective is in place.
Thank you. Ms. Zachariah?
Certainly for the Yahoo incident. I'm not trying, so on the telecom side of Verizon, that's a little bit of a complicated question, but for the Yahoo incident that we're here talking about today, absolutely.
Thank you very much. In the absence of the chairman, I recognize the senator, Senator Baldwin.
Thank you. I want to just start with a question of the panel, Mr. Barros, Mr. Smith, and Mr. Wilkinson in particular, just to identify if you have any information today about who hacked Equifax, who possesses the personal identifying information of about 145 million Americans, and what you believe they intend to do with it. Can you identify to me if any of you have that information today?
No, we have no evidence.
The only thing I'll add, Senator, is we engaged the FBI on August 2nd.
Yep.
I've been working with and cooperating with the FBI since August 2nd.
In our experience, in the vast majority of these breaches, once the breach has occurred, everyone owns this data because it's out in the public.
Thank you. So we all know that the Equifax breach compromised the personal and financial information of more than 145 million Americans. And we really can't even begin to know what ramifications this failure will have to the families and individuals that are impacted. And I think it's clear that Equifax needs to do a lot more than it has to help victims respond to this breach. Mr. Barros, will you make a commitment right here and now that Equifax will proactively notify every person who was impacted in this breach? Yes or no?
We have been notifying, we have been working with consumers, we have improved our web page, make sure that social media is active on that in that moment. We have been working with the consumers that have reached to us, and I have a team working every day to make sure that we engage consumers to do so.
I know that you've acted in areas where state law demands that you do so. Where it doesn't, are you going to reach out to each and every individual that you believe was impacted by this breach to let them know?
We will execute according to the requirements that they have in the law. Yeah.
And if there's an absence of law in a state, you won't do anything?
We are actively engaging with consumers to make sure that they use the product that we have today.
Equifax set up a poorly functioning process where people would have to go to the Equifax website to find out if they were impacted. How many people have gone through this process?
We have, as Mr. Smith mentioned on his statement last time, we had close to, for a period of time, we have close to 400 million hits.
Do you know how many individuals?
No, 30 million individuals have
30 million?
30 million, yeah.
Out of 145 million. You mentioned call centers in your testimony. Where are Equifax's call centers located?
We have in Lake City, Florida, and we have in Nevada, in Las Vegas.
And where?
The two major operations that we have is in Lake City in North Florida, where I visited a couple of Saturdays ago, and one in Las Vegas as well.
Are there any outside of the United States?
We use our, for surge impact, we use call centers in Costa Rica, We use call centers in Costa Rica, we use call centers in other parts of the world, that's correct.
What other parts of the world?
It varies from Malaysia, India, it depends on how the demand goes. Most of the calls that we have handled recently have been for specific products have been here in the U.S.
Most of them?
Yeah.
Equifax,
out of the surge. When we had a surge, we used the flexibility, the capacity that we have.
Equifax is now offering free credit report locking for life, but only offering credit report monitoring through January 31st, 2018. Will you make a commitment that Equifax will offer free credit report monitoring for life?
We have the first service that was available, which is the Trusted ID Premier, actually is valid for a year. So if you enroll until January, you have another 12 months to use the product with the five characteristics that has been described. The new product that we've put in place where consumers can lock and unlock their credit file will be available for free and for life at the end of January.
And monitoring?
We don't have the scope of the project to be monitoring at this stage.
Victims of this breach will really need to be able to control access to the reports from all three credit agencies to fully protect themselves. The other agencies charge between $5 and $10 for each and every freeze. Will you be offering rebates to the victims to cover their freezing costs with the other reporting agencies?
Senator, I believe that the resolution has to be one that protects the consumer, has to be sustainable, has to be scalable, has to be industry-driven, and work with the government to make sure that we reach out to the consumers to execute that. We gave our first step forward, which was to offer a service that consumers can check and lock and unlock their credit data for free and for life. And we want to work with the industry to make sure that we have a similar capacity to do it.
Mr. Barris, your firm recently completed an internal review of the stock trades executed by four senior Equifax executives prior to the public disclosure of the breach and hack. The special committee report found that, quote, none of the four executives engaged in insider trading. The report failed to mention that Equifax's chief legal officer, John J. Kelly, approved some of the stock sales on the same day that he called the FBI to alert it that the company had a problem. It took Mr. Kelly two more weeks to inform the executives that they were no longer allowed to sell stock. This is totally inappropriate, and yet the report does not even mention Mr. Kelly, and he still works for Equifax. I would like to ask both Mr. Barros and Mr. Smith, do you believe Mr. Kelly's failure to act was appropriate?
I think it's not my perspective to provide if it was appropriate or not. The board has actively, inconclusive, defined the four executives, did the preclearance in a correct form. The board is still, the special committee continues to investigate or to review the process as it relates to the cybersecurity incident, including policies and procedures.
Mr. Smith?
The only thing I'd add, Senator, is there is a full investigation by the independent directors of the board. You saw the report that was published, I think it was earlier this week or last week. Second thing I'd say, it is not unusual for us to engage outside counsel, outside forensic experts, in this case, mandate, or the FBI. I mentioned earlier to one of the senators, we have 3 to 4 million suspicious activities, suspicious attempts at our database around the world. So it's not unusual that, by the way, he didn't engage FBI, it was the security team. That is not an unusual step in itself.
Thank you, Senator Baldwin. Senator Cortez Masto.
Thank you. And first of all, let me just say thank you, Chair, and the ranking member for holding this hearing. Really appreciate that. So let me start with Equifax and some of the concerns I have. I'm from Nevada. There's about 3 million people there, and of the 3 million people, 1.3 million were impacted by this breach. Received over 4 dozen letters. Let me just give you an example of one of them. I have a woman in Carland who wrote, "No citizen has a say in the reporting practices of businesses to credit bureaus. I did not choose Equifax to store my information, nor did my husband, nor any of our children. Yet it is there, and clearly Equifax did not do enough to protect our information." So a couple of questions to start with, and I want to drill down into the data that is collected, because I think part of this is the data collection, and we should be looking at that. Equifax, my understanding of the breach of the 145 million consumers, the data that was collected was names of those consumers, social security numbers, addresses, birth dates, driver's license numbers, and credit card information. Is that true? Yes or no?
In some cases, yes. Some cases, no.
What other data do you collect on consumers besides the data that I just identified?
We have the piece of the that was affected only included, most of the data included social security numbers, name, date of birth, and address. That's it.
What other data do you collect other than what I just identified?
We have
so I'm going to ask for the record. We'll submit that. If Equifax could provide me with that question,
absolutely,
that would be very helpful. Because I'm curious, does Yahoo collect driver's license numbers?
Not to my knowledge.
Okay. So I think that's helpful in this discussion. Because to me, the data breach that happened at Equifax is egregious. It happens all the time. We're all getting pinged. Government's getting pinged. Companies are getting pinged. We've heard it. I think from what I've heard from Ms. Mayer, cybersecurity is a global challenge. We're always all getting pinged. It is incumbent upon all of us, including the private sector, to not only have the top line security, sophisticated security, always evolving with it, always ensuring that you're protecting that data. And when you fail to do that, then yes, you should be held accountable and the enforcement should be swift and consumers should be notified and there should be restitution for those consumers. But we haven't had the discussion on the data. To me, that's what this is about, because quite frankly, even those individuals that you work with now and those consumers that had credit locks and credit freezes, their data was still breached, correct?
Could be, yes. If they
right, so it doesn't matter, because that's what they're going to go after, is that Social Security number. And I see, Mr. Wilkinson, you're nodding yes. Isn't that correct?
Yes, Senator.
So shouldn't consumers be the ones to say, I want to opt in or opt out when it comes to the data that I am sharing with you? Don't you agree?
Well, this is part of the way the economy works. I mean, when the consumer goes
the consumer doesn't have a choice, sir. The consumer does not have a choice in the data that you're collecting. That's what I hear from my consumers. That's what I hear all the time. I know it. And quite frankly, the credit reports that I get as a consumer do not tell me all the data that you're collecting on me. Isn't that true?
The credit report collects the trade lines that we have on there.
That's true, isn't it? And then let me just say, I was Attorney General for 8 years in the state of Nevada. identity theft in the state of Nevada and across this country is through the roof. And every day dealt with somebody whose identity was stolen. And what is so egregious about what you have done is now for the rest of their lives, the woman in Carlin and all of the people that I hear from Nevada, of the 1.3 million people whose identities were stolen, they are going to have to clear their record for the rest of their lives. And what does that mean? That means that somebody's going to buy a boat in their name, a house in their name. People are going to commit crimes in their name. And believe me, as a prosecutor, I've seen it. So they're spending the rest of their lives clearing their record and their good name. And that's why this is so egregious. And I think you have an obligation not only to look at the data that you're collecting, but make sure you're protecting it. And if there is a breach, you're doing everything you can to remediate and bring restitution to those individuals whose information is stolen. So let me talk to you, because I've got a short period of time. Mr. Wilkinson, you talked about the data and Social Security numbers and the idea that now we have to look at a different way of identifying the PEII. I'm very curious if you have anything specific on what we should be doing when we're looking at that data and PII that is shared and collected.
Well, the first thing to note has been noted a few times, which is in the case of these breaches, in the case of this most recent breach, 145 million items of personal information was leaked. When you combine this with other breaches that have occurred, and you know, there's a list of breaches that we could cite, we're getting very close to all of the personal information in the United States has already been breached in some way. So, of course, the question applies, which is, what are we trying to protect at this point? In the case of some of the financial card breaches, like the Target breach from several years ago or 3 years ago that we actually testified, my company testified on behalf of the requester peer at that time, I think there's a good point to compare and contrast between what's happened with some of those breaches and in this case, and that is the financial payment system is reasonably resilient. In that case, despite the fact that it was a burden for consumers, the ability for consumers to have a new card reissued, have that fraud remediated, and be back in business, the ability to do commerce is relatively well known and relatively resilient. In addition, the liability largely fell to the financial institutions, the issuers of those financial cards, credit cards, debit cards. So I think looking to some examples like what we see in financial payments ecosystem is an example of a more resilient system than what we have in this form of identity today. But our identities are out there, so I continue to reinforce that our position is that we believe that a more resilient identity framework needs to be brought forward. There's several examples. I cited
one. And I'm running out of time, and I know my time is up, but let me just say this. I agree with you. Our identities are out there. Some of us are, it's too late. But to our kids, it's not too late.
Right.
And we've got to look to the future and protecting their information as well. So it is something that, to me, it's not static. We've got to continue to figure out how we address this issue if we're going to talk about digital identities or the government coming up with something different. But I do agree with you that there should be that public-private partnership. We've got to figure this out for the benefit of those people that we're taking their data and they have no choice. They have no choice that companies are taking their personal information, they're monetizing it, and then they get stuck for the rest of their lives dealing with the results of a breach. So thank you.
Thank you, Senator Masto. Senator Hassan.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, and good morning to all of our panelists. This is a question to the panel, although the most relevant example that we can call on is the response from Equifax this summer to the major data breach it endured. There are state-by-state laws requiring private and public entities to notify individuals when there are security breaches of their personally identifiable information. These laws represent the lowest amount of communication required. I'm interested in what companies are deciding to proactively do to help notify and help the consumers affected by these breaches. So, we could start perhaps with Mr. Smith and Mr. Barros. I know that you have both stated that Equifax has taken big steps to further the consumer satisfaction in their interactions with your company. But many of those steps seem to have come only after public outcry to your initial response. So my question more broadly is, can each of you elaborate on what considerations you and your companies take into account when determining steps to notify and remediate the damage done to consumers from data breaches?
Senator, if I may start, and Mr. Barros, if you want to add on. One, on the notification process, we took to obviously very seriously the state requirements as far as time and notification.
But of course, I'm asking beyond that, because those are minimal. So what are you guys now deciding to do beyond that, and how do you, what considerations are you making?
Well, just one of my top priorities has been to consumer response and hardening our security system. This is what I mentioned at the beginning. On the consumer side, we definitely made our call centers more scalable. We improved our platforms. So in other words, you can get in and out, you can have access within 3 minutes, you can have a response back.
But I am also talking about your proactive efforts to notify consumers beyond the requirements that state law, for instance, gives
correct.
You.
Now, with model hits that we have, we've been working with the consumers to making sure that they use the services that we have provided for free for them for the transitional period. And we'll continue to do again when we introduce our new lock and unlock for free for life.
Well, Mr. Smith.
Senator, the one thing I'd add is that the process we did use was one legal and acceptable, and it seemed like it worked. He mentioned we had 450 million consumers.
We can pursue this on the record. That isn't my question, and I want to get to the other panelists. I'm asking for now, regardless of state law is a minimum, you have to follow it. But what are the factors that you are considering when you decide when to notify a consumer? And if any of the other panelists would like to answer just very briefly, that would be helpful.
At Yahoo, we generally took a proactive stance due to the global nature of our business, which is to say, yes, laws vary from state to state, but our view was frequently, if user notification was required anywhere, we did it everywhere.
Right.
And we endeavored to be both accurate and comprehensive, because accuracy and comprehensiveness are very important, as well as analyze how any data might have been misused or abused, and also be swift in the response.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, at Verizon, what we do is first we always obviously look at what the law requires, but then we look at what we think is the right thing to do for the customer. And if in a particular situation we think it's the right thing to notify the customer, then that's what we do.
Thank you. You also?
Our company doesn't hold consumer information, so it's not applicable.
I didn't think so, but just checking. I wanted to follow up with Mr. Barros about the difference between credit lock and credit freeze services. Placing a freeze on their credit is one of the best ways consumers can protect themselves, of course, from identity fraud. Equifax has stated that it will waive the fee for consumers to place a freeze on their credit for several more months in response to the major data breach earlier this year. At that point, the company has stated, and I believe you stated in your testimony, Mr. Smith, that it will offer consumers the ability to lock their credit for free. Can you please share with the committee the legal differences between a credit lock and a credit freeze in terms of consumers' rights and protections, and who has access to a consumer's credit report when it is frozen versus locked?
Fundamentally, there's no difference between a lock and a freeze. When you freeze, you use a regulatory process to do it. Then you make a phone call, you identify yourself, you get a PIN, and you're ready to execute a freeze or not. When you do the lock, the reason why you did a lock was the simplicity of the process. So in financial institutions, they're trying to get to your file to open an account, won't be able to do. In both situations, they're frozen, was the file is frozen or the file is locked?
Well, and I see that my time is up. I think there are experts who would disagree with you in terms of your statement that there's no difference between a freeze or a lock. And one of the things I will follow up with you in writing about is the degree of fees that Equifax gets from helping consumers unfreezing or unlocking their information. Thank you for your indulgence, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Hassan. Senator Capito.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I thank all of the panelists for being here today. I want to start with a simple question to Mr. Barros. To your knowledge, has any of the information that was breached and you know, we driver's license, social security, birth dates, addresses, credit card information, do you have any indication that any of those customers that you or folks that you have whose data was breached has been misused? Or did you have any indication that somebody was using this data to make other purchases or other things of that nature?
To the best of my knowledge, it's premature to make an assessment that has been used already. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Ms. Meyer, what about in terms of Yahoo and the data that was breached there? Did you have any indications at Yahoo that an individual's data had been misused? Was that a red flag that was brought to your company?
No, we saw no volume of reports. We did roll out a program, Advanced Protection Against Threats, that notified users if we saw any indication that their account might be accessed by a state-sponsored attacker, and we rolled out that program, I believe, in 2015. So users are notified in real time if there's any suspicious activity on their accounts.
Right. So, Mr. Wilkinson, in light of the fact that you said all this information is in the public domain, not just with the bad actors, but out there in general, probably, we would have to assume that. I mean, you're assuming that. I would assume that. Does it surprise you that that none of this information that's out there has been used in a nefarious way that anybody can detect at this point?
Yes, it would surprise me if none of it had been used in a nefarious way to this point, given the time frame that we're talking about.
Yes, that surprises me as well. Mr. Barros, you mentioned in terms of how were individuals contacted, noting that obviously Yahoo has a direct communication with their customers through their email accounts. All of the data that's collected here does not seem to indicate any kind of email address or phone number that you can send out a mass warning signal. So your customers basically, have to opt in to find out. And you said you've been out on social media telling them the ways to do that. Would that change your profile in terms of being able to have quicker, more efficient, and wider spread way to disseminate information to those of the folks who information that you're collecting? Some kind of a communication tool with all these individuals?
It frustrates also us because we'd like to have more, to be more in front with the consumer and proactively doing that. As I said, we have improved significantly our website. It's much more friendly today. It's easier to assess. We have more phone numbers available for consumers to ask questions. These phone numbers are public. Our website has these phone numbers there as well. We have proactively doing this through social media, inviting people to talk to us
right,
to make sure that we can respond and direct them to the right solution.
Well, I can tell you that one of the ways that people want to talk to you is when they get their credit report and they see something on there that they don't agree with. And I think that your company through the years and the credit bureaus in general have realized that this is an enormous problem for the American consumer if there's a false entry on their credit report, especially if it's one that knocks down their credit rating. And I know that happens frequently, and I know you've worked to try to correct this problem and try to reach the consumer. But I would hope that having myself tried to do this with my own personal credit report and how frustrating it is to get through to whoever I was trying to get through to, Equifax or which of the other two, to try to register a complaint and work through the process, very time-consuming and difficult. So I'm going to assume that those processes are tightening up, particularly in light of this security breach that we've seen at your company, in terms of consumer friendliness.
Right. It's one of the top concerns that I have is how to improve response to consumers. We are looking at all this process to make sure that we have a better way to communicate with consumers.
And I'm also interested in your proposal to lock your information as an individual that you said you would have on stream in January at cost free, where the customer could opt in and then opt out, unlock and lock their own personal data. How does that work in terms of your business framework? If a consumer locks the data out, are you then locked out to reporting to your customer how that customer's data would influence their credit rating in terms of purchasing a home or something like that?
Yeah, it's part of the process. So the objective that we have when we designed the service was to make sure that the consumer would have the power on their hand to lock and unlock their file.
So when they have a locked file, it's locked from you disseminating it to anybody?
Nobody can have access to that information on that file.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Capito. Next up is Senator Gardner.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you to our witnesses for being here today. I hear a lot of conversations about your file, meaning your personal information. I've heard it said that this is consumer information. This is personal identification information. Mr. Burrows, can you tell me who owns the information that you provide to your clients, customers?
Sorry. According to the existing regulatory framework, we own the information.
Does a consumer have any ability to say, I don't want you to have that information?
They have the opportunity today to unlock and unlock their file, and therefore not allow anyone to have access to it.
But do I have an ability to say, I don't want Equifax to have any information about me?
I understand. This is what I said. I understand that from the regulatory framework that we have today, the consumer cannot exit out of the file.
So the answer is no. So I, as a consumer, apply for a credit card or a bank loan. That institution then provides it to you, and I have no ability to stop that from happening.
You can lock and unlock your file.
So the answer is no, I can't stop that. And the answer is no, I can't prevent you from getting it. So whose information is this? Is it your file, or is it my file, or is it your file? Whose file is it?
According to the regulatory perspective, I have the information.
So it's your file, not my file. So all the information about me, all the consumer information I produce, all the data, everything that I own that defines my life, I have no control over that. Is that correct? Other than you've got it and I can tell you whether I want you to give it or sell it to somebody else.
This is how the industry framework.
I get it. Do you think it's right though?
I think it's not my perspective to say it's right or wrong. Just the regulatory perspective that we work on it.
Who owns the credit card information that you have on me? That's you then at that point, correct?
I just have a trade line on your credit card information.
So, do you think consumers should own their data?
I think my perspective.
Ms. Mayor, should consumers own their data, own their own information?
Yes, I believe that they should.
Should we be able to control our own information, Mr. Burrows?
Yeah, well, this is the effort that we're making to the process. We believe that we should control the information that we have, the credit.
But you're saying by putting a lock or an unlock that can be hacked by somebody is consumer control.
Now, when you lock and unlock your file, nobody can have access to your file.
Would you support a mechanism that allowed consumers to say, I don't want that information to go to Equifax, Experian, TransUnion?
This is a decision that is bigger than our industry. I think we need to understand how the economy is going to behave in that perspective.
Mr. Smith, it's my understanding that the data access through Equifax's consumer dispute portal was not encrypted at rest. Is that correct?
Correct.
If the answer is yes, as you said it was the fact that this data remained unencrypted at rest the result of an oversight, or was that a decision that was made to manage that data unencrypted at rest?
There are multiple tools we use and used to use when I was there to secure data: encryption at rest, encryption in motion, tokenization, masking, firewalls. Multiple layers of security. Encryption is only one. If you look across our...
So a decision was made to leave it unencrypted at rest?
Correct.
Mr. Burrows, since you took over as part of your internal response to the breach, have you directed the company to encrypt such data? Or have you been recommended to encrypt such data so it is encrypted at rest?
We have done a top-down review, comprehensive top-down review of our security situation. We use outside companies to help us to do that, PwC and Median. We are strengthening our
Let me just, areas. Yes or no question. Does the data remain unencrypted at rest?
It's going to be part of the process, has been reviewed.
Yes or no, does the data remain unencrypted at rest?
I don't know at this stage.
You don't know if this is the reason why it was breached, is that correct? This data was unencrypted.
Encryption is one format of defense. We have several formats on defense and tools in place now that can prevent this to happen.
Encryption is one type. And this data remains unencrypted at rest.
We have deployed several different tools, and encryption is one tool.
Senator, if I may, it's my understanding the entire environment in which this criminal attack occurred is now much different. It's a more modern environment with multiple layers of security that did not exist before. encryption is only one of those levels of security.
Now, there's other experts, the privacy experts here. Is it a reliable, safe methodology to leave this data unencrypted at rest? Mr. Wilkinson?
I think we've spoken to the high value of identity information and what it can be used for today. Certainly, as Mr. Smith noted, encryption is one of the tools, but certainly from our company's perspective, a very important one to be used for data that is data of this type that is of high value.
So your answer is it is
yes.
Irresponsible to leave this unencrypted at rest?
Other segments of the industry, I've mentioned a few examples of the payments ecosystem, have requirements around PCI requirements that require this kind of information, credit card data at retailers and things like that to be encrypted. In this case, it was not.
When, Mr. Smith, I know my time has expired. If I could ask one more question. When specifically did you notify the other credit reporting agencies about the breach?
Senator, we notified them. We notified the public.
So the public and the other, and that was around August. Can you give me the date again?
September 7th was when we went live.
September 7th. The breach occurred August 2nd, September 7th.
We saw suspicious activity on the 29th and 30th of July. Notified the FBI the 2nd.
I'm sorry, that was the 2nd. Yeah.
That's when we notified the FBI, and we went public with it on the 2nd, 7th of September.
So 7th of September is when the other credit rating agencies also received that information?
That's when we went public with the entire breach, yes.
Yeah, thank you. Is Equifax currently under investigation by the Department of Justice or SEC?
There are multiple investigations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Gardner. Senator Young.
Thank you, Chairman. I thank our panelists for being here today. Ms. Mayor, you were CEO of Yahoo at the time of the largest data breach in all of human history, the so-called 2013 and 2014 breaches. You've testified here today that the 2014 breach was state-sponsored, but you have not concluded that the 2013 breach was state-sponsored. Is that correct?
We have not been able to determine who perpetrated the 2013 breach.
Okay, thank you. You've testified today you didn't learn of either data breach until 2016. Is that correct?
I learned of the breaches at the scale reported in 2016. In December of 2014, we saw a Russian intrusion in our network, and we saw 26 individuals, all with Russian connections and of political interest in Russia, with accounts compromised. We notified the FBI, and we put in place a special notice for those users that had to be dismissed by user action to make sure they were aware that this had happened.
Thank you. Is it correct that you didn't learn of the 2013 breach until 2016?
That's right.
Okay. What sort of information can you provide this committee that supports your claims that you didn't learn of the 2013 breach and until 2016?
Our board formed an independent committee, and they have reported on their findings.
Okay, and that's all publicly available?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Smith, Mr. Barros, the former and current CEOs of Equifax, I'm grateful for your presence here today. I represent over 6.5 million Hoosiers, 3.8 million Hoosiers, 3.8 million Hoosiers, 60% of Indiana's population was impacted by Equifax's data breach. Can you see why they feel like companies like Equifax don't have their back? Yes?
Yes, Senator.
Okay. One of the tragic things about this whole episode is that many of these Hoosiers, many Americans won't discover until a number of years down the road that there was, in fact, a data breach. A single mother of a few children gets a new job in Gary, Indiana, goes to buy a car because this job requires her to drive, and she finds out her credit's been ruined. What is Equifax going to do to remedy this situation for that single mother?
Paulino, let me jump in first. Maybe then you add to it. That was the idea behind the lifetime ability to lock and unlock your file that we talked about in at four prior hearings. If it's locked, Senator, you don't have the ability to go rent a house falsely in your name. You can't or rent an apartment, get access to
that's prospective and prophylactic, defensive, and it seems like a good thing to do. Let me return to that momentarily. I will say, we've had these massive data breaches, and it is an effrontery
to the basic sense of fairness to most Americans that the top executives leave with tens of millions of dollars. I'm not trying to make a class warfare argument, but when I see the United States Navy just fired two top officers in the Pacific on account of some sailors that died in the wake of the USS John McCain situation, and they were separated from the military service because of a loss of confidence. I think this is an issue that we collectively in Congress need to start discussing more seriously if the titans of free enterprise here in the United States of America don't take more seriously, and I'm talking about boards as well as executives, when things like this happen. It's just, it offends the sensibilities of most Americans. Can you understand that? Why that would offend the sensibilities of Americans for them to be on the receiving end of a data breach and within months somebody leaves with tens of millions, maybe hundreds of millions of dollars?
I understand your point, Senator, but as I've said in prior testimonies, I've left with nothing except the pension. I've asked for nothing. I waived my bonus. There's no equity coming next year. I'm working for 3 months to 6 months, as long as needed, for free in an advisory capacity.
Yeah.
What I'm walking away with, which all disclosed in the proxy, is my pension.
Yeah. Ms. Mary, you don't need to answer the question. I don't need to personalize it. I'm just talking about culturally. Big business in this country. I'd like to touch on one policy issue before I move forward. The idea that credit reporting agencies moving forward will give consumers the right to request a locking of access to their credit files at no cost to them. Can you pledge, Mr. Barros, that 5 years from now, Equifax won't be charging consumers to lock and unlock their credit files? And would you be opposed to Congress implementing a law today that states unequivocally that industry can't charge to lock or unlock an unlimited number of times each year?
Thank you, Senator. I think the proposal that we have put forward, which you definitely, we expect to lead the industry in that direction, where consumers can lock and unlock their files, is free for life. This is the commitment that Equifax has made. And I definitely welcome the conversation with the rest of the industry.
Absolutely.
And the government.
Yeah. Thank you for that. Thank you all.
Thank you, Senator Young. Senator Cantwell.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you for holding this hearing. We've had several larger Commerce Committee hearings on cybersecurity, certainly had some in the Energy Committee, and I think Homeland Security has had some. I think the Armed Services Committee has had some. I think now is the time for us to be very serious about passing legislation, as we did out of the Senate, that would help us fight the issue of cybercrime and particularly help strengthen our critical infrastructure against state actor attacks. As Ms. Mayer mentioned, but these aren't the only things that are being attacked. Our networks at nuclear power plants, our pipelines, a whole variety of things. And as we continue to grow the economy of the Internet of Things, the hearing we just had, I guess that was yesterday, we also heard about how more devices and more connectivity means more data entry portals for people to attack. So a couple of things about, I hope our committee will join in the efforts to get cyber security legislation over the goal line this year. I think it's not too soon to act. I too want to bring up that there's 3 million Washingtonians that were impacted by the Equifax, according to my information. It's my understanding, Mr. Barros, that a patch was available that was not implemented, like a basic hygiene issue wasn't followed. Is that correct?
That is correct.
Why can't Mr. Barros answer that question? Because he doesn't know, or because
he was not in the position at the time.
Okay.
Yeah, I came to the position 6 weeks ago, and this is my understanding. My understanding is the same as being deposed here by Mr. Smith. What happened was a combination of human error and technology. I defer to him because he actually lived through this process.
What was the technology error if a patch was available and it wasn't implemented by an employee? And the reason I'm asking you about this,
sure,
and I understand the dual role here, but my point is this. We have to do both. The issue of cybersecurity is here. It's here. It's a national security issue. It's a consumer issue. It's a future issue on identity theft and the ability for individuals to protect the things that they hold dear. So we have to do both. We have to, at the federal level, up our game and make sure that we're making investments to help on critical infrastructure and certainly addressing this issue on an international basis. What do we need to put into place on an international basis to get people on the same page in fighting cybercrime? We have to do that. But at the same time, we need to make sure that everybody gets hygiene and that the hygiene of your day-to-day business and even your home computer and everything else is going to be a critical aspect of the world that we now live in. So I want you to know and be able to speak to the fact that, you know, one individual failing to put a patch in place caused this much damage.
We have done since I got to this job, my first priority has been to harden our security systems. We have done a comprehensive review of the process, improving our patching capabilities, improving our tools, updating our tools, making sure that our detecting process is much more up to speed at this stage. We have changed the policies. We have changed the policies to making sure that we have redundancies and closed loops in place in order to improve the accuracy and precision of our execution.
Do you think it's good enough to have voluntary safeguards for the industry, or is it time to have something more stringent?
I understand the safeguards that we have. I think they provide the scope, and which we comply with the scope before. The industry is ahead of that in many perspectives, deploying new tools, using new tools. We'll definitely welcome the conversation.
I would say that we need something more at this point in time, that if on the hygiene issue, one employee was able to miss something as critical as this and put so much data at risk, that we need something to make sure that this is implemented. Anybody else on the panel want to answer that question? Mr. Wilkinson.
The vulnerability that we're speaking about, not that you want the specifics of it, was called the Apache Struts. Came out. We were aware of it in March. We became aware of it in March publicly. This is a zero-day vulnerability. These types of vulnerabilities are serious, and they happen more often than we'd like to speak about. When we become aware of zero-day threats, our need to react to those kinds of threats is quick and has to be conclusive. This is something that we're going to continue to see. It's not new. It's going to continue to happen. This concept that you continue to speak about, Senator, of cybersecurity hygiene is a very important one, because I liken it a little bit to locks on doors. We can speak for a bit about the fact that no matter what we do, there's still some vulnerability in our ecosystem. There's still some possibility that we'll be breached. But some of these best practices are frankly just like locks on your front door. Just because that's not going to protect you against all crime, you'd still put a lock on your front door. Good cyber hygiene includes things like reacting quickly to zero-day threats.
Exactly. So that is my point exactly. Thank you so much for that, because you just explained that you have to have. Okay, we have our national labs working day and night against the unbelievable amount of attacks that are happening every single day. We have all of this effort that we're now going to try to do, both in getting a skilled workforce that this committee had a hearing on, to doing everything else. But we need companies to follow a hygiene with great religious fervorance. I believe that we have to help do our part too, because if state-owned actors are going to continue to hack, we need to do something. But we need the companies to follow a hygiene and be very religious about it. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I know my time's expired.
Thank you, Senator Cantwell. Next up is Senator Peters.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and thank you so much for putting together this hearing. This is an incredibly important topic, and I think it angers most folks as they hear about this incident and the impact that it's going to have on over 140 million Americans. In the case of the Equifax breach, over 4 million in my state. And I just want to expand a little bit before I have some questions on Senator Cantwell's questions to Mr. Wilkinson. My understanding, I just want to be clear of this, this was a vulnerability that was discovered. There was a patch created. The information went out. And that means, what my understanding is, when these go out, bad guys find out about them as well. You're basically broadcasting that there is a vulnerability that people can figure out pretty easily. So at least some of the experts I've talked to have said, this was not a sophisticated hack. It was a pretty simple hack because the roadmap was pretty much put out for folks to take. So we've had discussions about national or state actors involved, highly sophisticated networks. This was just basically a roadmap was put out for the bad guys, and they jumped in and got in. Is that correct?
It is. I think it goes back to the discussion of, you know, when zero-day threats are publicized, they do create a bit of a roadmap for the bad guys, as you said, which is one of the reasons why the need to respond quickly to close down those types of threats in your ecosystem is very, very important.
Right.
Again, it's best practices.
Hygiene. And I just want to paint the picture for the American public to know that basically a roadmap was put out for all the bad guys out there who want to do us harm, that there is a vulnerability, and we have a company that has some of the most sensitive personal information about each and every one of us. And as we heard from testimony earlier, we don't have any choice in the matter. Companies can collect all this information, and they don't even take the time to look at a roadmap that has just been put out that there's a breach. You know, I can't think of a clear definition of gross negligence anywhere. A company that has been entrusted with this most sensitive data, and customers didn't have a choice for you to hold it, you're holding it. I didn't ask Equifax to have that information. No one asked to do that. You're holding that, and you don't take the precautions when a roadmap has been put out. So I guess, you know, the other question to you, Mr. Wilkinson, is that after a breach has occurred, is that oftentimes a criminal may wait some time, too, before using this data?
Absolutely.
So this may be a while before we actually see it being used.
Yes.
Can you say, in your professional opinion, is there ever a point after a breach, especially one of this magnitude, where consumers could no longer fear the formation of fraudulent accounts or this could be used against them?
No, Senator, and I think that goes back to my original comments, which is this type of data being out in the wild, if you will, is forever now exposed and will never be credibly used for secure identity again.
So we have to worry about this the rest of our lives.
Yes.
So we have to worry about this the rest of our lives. Mr. Barrows, you mentioned that there's free credit monitoring for 1 year. Is that correct for folks who may have been victims of this?
Sorry. Yeah, it started, and since we announced the breach on September 7th, we extended this until the end of January, and after that point, you still have 12 months.
So why only 12 months when we've heard that we have to worry about this the rest of our life?
Because I strongly believe that the action that had to come out of this has to be to protect the consumers.
For 1 year?
No,
why not for the rest of their life, which is the risk?
The product that we have offered today is a step forward that direction where the consumer can lock and unlock their file, and it's free for life.
But that is only with your company. This information, as we heard, can now be used with any of the other access to any of the other credit reporting agencies. There's all sorts of avenues now that you can basically use this information to create a false identity. And you're saying that your response as a company, you can lock your credit with us going forward, but you still have vulnerabilities with all of the other agencies. That they'll just go to it. I mean, this is pretty simple. If you're a bad guy, just don't go to Equifax, go to one of the others. I've got the keys to the kingdom. I'm gonna go other places. You know, we have to create incentives, and I've heard that from the panelists, incentives to stop this type of behavior and to make sure people put the highest standards in place, and certainly gross negligence should never be acceptable. To me, what we need to do is, from an incentive standpoint, is if you're giving information of mine, and I did not ask to have that information given, I understand you make money when you provide information to financial institutions. You make money on my information, which I have never asked you to use. At a minimum, you should let me know you're making money off of that information, and I should actually give you permission to give my information out. If you're going to make money, I don't understand why I don't have the ability and the tools for any kind of agency right now to be able to make sure that I have control. As we've talked about, this should be my information that we control. So, you know, I'm out of time right now, but I think, you know, this raises a host of major issues related to privacy and control of data. And right now, we don't have the kinds of incentives to get companies to really protect that information. You profit from that information. You don't protect that information. You allowed a simple, unsophisticated hack to have access to 140 million people's most private information. There needs to be some strong liability. Companies that do not protect information and jeopardize Americans for the rest of their life need to be subjected to strict liability and need to be stepping up and making sure that those consumers are protected for the rest of their lives. And hopefully that's something we can consider as we move forward in this committee. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Senator Peters. I have Senator Markey has returned, Senator Markey, Senator Duckworth, and Senator Klobuchar.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, very much. Mr. Chairman, the public wants us to do more to protect their privacy and security. Yet earlier this year, Congress formally rescinded the Federal Communications Commission's broadband privacy and security rules, which ensured that broadband companies like Verizon adopt reasonable data security protections. These protections ensured broadband providers implement up-to-date best data security practices, provide appropriate oversight of security practices, properly dispose of sensitive information, and notify affected consumers within 30 days of a breach. Yet Verizon opposed these data security and privacy protections and played an instrumental role in ensuring that they were, in fact, repealed. Broadband providers like Verizon argued that we needed a light touch regulatory framework like those governing websites like Equifax and Yahoo. Well, 3 billion Yahoo account users and 145 million Americans have now learned that light touch means hands off. Light touch means no protections. Light touch means free rein. And now, because of congressional action, free rein for broadband providers like Verizon to collect, use, share, and sell consumers' most sensitive information without their consent is the law. Free rein to ignore reasonable data security protections and avoid promptly notifying consumers when their sensitive information has been compromised. Ms. Zakaria, your testimony states that security has always been in Verizon's DNA. And during today's hearing, you stated that Verizon would support national data security legislation. But Verizon actively and vigorously lobbied to eliminate these data security and privacy breach notification protections. How are these two positions consistent?
Senator, Verizon believes that there should be a single national framework when it comes to data security and privacy. We do support legislation in both of those areas, and we'd be very happy, as I said earlier, to work with your office or other members of this committee on what that legislation should look like. But we do think that there should be one overarching framework, and this CRA was not that.
Yeah, well, here's where we are. Now we have nothing. You know, now we have nothing. So you repealed the law that actually required that there be protections. Now we have nothing. And from my perspective, you didn't have to repeal one of the most comprehensive data security and privacy frameworks to develop a national data security framework. You could have advocated for Congress to give the Federal Trade Commission the authority to prescribe data security protections to websites as well. Instead, Verizon opted to eliminate the rules altogether. So that's the problem that we have right now, that we had very strong, you know, data security and privacy protections that were on the books. And they were removed as part of a CRA, a vote on the floor of the Senate and the House earlier this year. So as we sit here, we hear concerns about the need to have legislation. We had it. We had it. And it was going to actually work in terms of ensuring that we would have those regulations that would be put on the books. But instead, we don't have anything. So I guess in retrospect, do you think it was in the public interest to eliminate these data security and breach notification protections, Ms. Zaccaria? If you could go back in time earlier this year, would you still remove those protections from the books?
Yes, I would, Senator. And again, we do think that there should be national data breach and
right. No, I appreciate that. We had it. You advocated strongly to remove the protections. Okay, that's what you did. And even today, you're not regretful at all. Okay, but that's kind of the environment within which we're working right now. That's where Yahoo was. That's where these other companies were, over in FTC lands. Okay, and we had a stronger regime that was in place and going to be made even stronger. And that's, in fact, what the American people want. They want real teeth to be put into these laws. They want real accountability from the private sector in terms of the guarantee that there is real security around this data that goes right to the very identity of who people are as citizens of our country. And instead of toughening those laws, this year there was weakening, a serious weakening. And I think ultimately we're going to pay a big price as year after year goes by. Because ultimately, it's not talk, it's going to be action that makes the difference. Those actions had been taken. They were on the books. They were starting to put a little teeth into the protections, and now that is gone. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Senator Markey. Obviously, some of us have a difference of opinion on that subject. I think there are ways that we can address data breach that don't specifically have as their principal objective enriching class action lawyers. But I do think rather than rehashing that debate, we ought to be looking at what we can do to prevent breaches, ensure that government enforcement agencies like the FTC, which can help make consumers whole, have the tools they need to hold bad actors accountable. Next up is Senator Duckworth.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and also thanking the ranking member for convening this important meeting. As today's proceedings make clear, the harm caused by these massive data breaches is incredibly far-reaching. And I just want to take a moment to highlight how both states and federal government entities rely on these agencies, such as Equifax, for services, for credit monitoring, for credit services. For example, Equifax's loss of millions of Social Security numbers endangers the well-being of our nation's veterans who receive VA disability benefits. Now, at the current time, the VA allows veterans to use a wide variety of methods to interact with the department. If a veteran is not comfortable going online, he or she can actually manage their disability benefit account by fax. So, for example, a veteran can fax a request to change the bank account into which their VA disability benefits are deposited, and those changes will be made if the form includes a Social Security number that matches the name of the requester. This policy and process was likely created in an era when your valid Social Security number could serve as an effective authentication tool. Obviously, that is no longer the case. So my initial questions to you, Mr. Barros and Mr. Smith, is simple. Following Equifax's loss of millions of Social Security numbers, what concrete steps did the company take to notify government agencies and specifically the United States Department of Veterans Affairs of the urgent need to strengthen authentication policies to prevent service-disabled veterans from having their benefits stolen?
We have, my team has actively worked with the Department of Defense, the Veterans Association, the Veterans Administration, the CFPB, the Senate, in order to make sure that we enhance the communication process and have solutions that will allow the military purpose to be informed about how to protect themselves using our services.
So when you went public with the information on the breach, when did you contact the DOD or the Department of Veterans Affairs to inform them of the significance of the breach and what they would have to do to strengthen their processes?
This happened when I can say what I did. Since I got here, I asked my people to make sure that they contacted DOD and the veteran associations, and they have done recently, 2 weeks ago.
Just a few weeks ago.
Yeah.
So there was anything done, Mr. Smith, do you know, was anything done when the breach was known and when it became public?
Specific to the veterans?
specific to government agencies in particular, but specifically to government agencies in particular, but specifically to the U.S. Department of Veterans Affairs and to the Department of Defense?
Not that I'm aware of.
So you just left our veterans exposed.
I'm just saying, not that I'm aware of.
Not that you're. Well, I'd like to know. So please find out and provide me with that information.
We'll do that.
So I want to be clear. The theft of VA disability benefits is an urgent problem that can be financially devastating for veterans who need these funds to pay their rent, to afford their groceries, and to keep the lights on. For even when a veteran notices that their disability benefit was not received and contacts the VA, this merely represents a first step in what is an unacceptably complex and onerous bureaucratic maze that a veteran must navigate to get their disability benefits restored. So as I understand it, this is what has to happen when a veteran discovers that, say, their disability check did not go into the bank account that it normally goes into. And thinking back to when this breach occurred, you'll see that veterans could still be suffering because you did not tell the VA, or hopefully you told them, but I you have no evidence that you have. First, the VA must confirm that with the financial institution where the money was sent erroneously, that it received the information. Then the VA has to work out an agreement with that financial entity to return those funds back to the U.S. Treasury Department's general fund. Then the VA must get a confirmation from the Treasury that the fraudulent payment was actually recouped, and then wait until Treasury actually returns the funds to VA before the VA would then send that money back to the veteran. In the best case scenario, this process can take weeks, but I wouldn't be surprised if it would take many months. Now, my office has warned various veteran service organizations of the need to notify their members of this danger, and I'm working with the VA to strengthen authentication policies and procedures. However, Mr. Barros, given your company's role in failing to safeguard this critical data, I would like Equifax's commitment to work with the VA, the veteran service organizations, and with individual veterans to provide valuable support and services such as unlimited, free, credit freezes, and monitoring for life. Will you make that commitment on behalf of the men and women who are willing to lay down their lives to protect you and your family and your business here in this country?
We have, again, actively engaged with the Department of Defense and the Veterans Association, the Veterans Administration, the CFPB, and the Senate. They will be offered the product that we have in jail. They can use it.
So you're not going to offer credit monitoring to our veterans who have been affected by your data breach for life?
We're going to offer for them the lock and unlock product, which is will provide the same barrier defense.
Again, as my colleague, Mr. Peters, just mentioned, that does not apply. That doesn't help because the bad guys are going to go somewhere else. So basically you're saying that you will not make this commitment to our nation's veterans.
The people
who protect your very ability to make money, who protect your freedoms. You will not support our veterans, our disabled veterans who were wounded in their service to this country. You will not provide credit monitoring to them for life.
We believe the lock and unlock product is a safer product than the monitoring that we have.
So the answer is no. I'm over time. I yield back, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Senator Duckworth. Senator Udall.
thank you so much, Chairman Thune, and thank you for holding this very important hearing. I must say some of the testimony is pretty discouraging here. There were 846,188 New Mexicans whose identity and possibly their creditworthiness was endangered by the blatant carelessness of Equifax employees. When you previously testified, Mr. Smith, you specifically said that the data was stolen was stored in plain text and had not been encrypted. This is an unacceptable practice for an organization with such power over consumers' lives, and it's painfully clear that Americans cannot rely on large companies that store their data to protect it. As one possible solution, Congress should consider banning the use of unverified Social Security numbers in commerce. There is the potential for strong bipartisan support for this. Social Security numbers were never intended to be used as universal online IDs. I'm glad to hear that the White House is looking at this idea, and Congress should also evaluate this possibility as well. In that regard, this committee should take a closer look at the work that the National Institute of Standards and Technology has initiated with the Trust Trusted Identities Group to develop secure online IDs and to ban the use of unverified Social Security numbers. I look forward to working with others and building on the work this group has already undertaken. The following are yes or no questions for all the panelists, and I'm interested in banning the use of unverified Social Security numbers. Is it necessary for online commerce to rely on a Social Security number? Mr. Bars. Please give me a yes or no. It's a simple question.
Social Security number is a process that was developed in 1936. I think we need to have a better digital imprint perspective when dealing with e-commerce.
So your answer is yes, it's necessary to rely on it.
Today, some sites do rely on it. Yep. It's not a safe.
Mr. Smith?
I'd love to see it replaced. Until there's a replacement, it's the standard.
Yeah, Ms. Mayer?
Yahoo does not collect or store Social Security numbers, so we did not need it for the conduct of our business.
Yeah.
Verizon's very happy to work with this committee and others to come up with an alternative for Social Security numbers.
Thank you. Mr. Wilkinson?
Social Security numbers, a static identity, is a basis for our online identities, will not be secure, is not secure, and will never be secure in the future.
Do your businesses, another yes or no question, do your businesses require a consumer's Social Security number before you will do business with them?
Most of our business is done business to business, so we deal mostly with entities.
But so,
there's a small portion of our business that require information that varies
okay.
from the consumer side.
Mr. Smith?
I concur.
Ms. Mayer?
No.
Zachariah?
The answer is no, but it is part of, it's not a requirement, but it is part of a typical way that we'll go through a credit check for a new customer.
Mr. Wilkinson?
We're focused in the B2B area, and I don't collect consumer information and or security, Social Security numbers.
Thank you. Another question. Do you think the development of a security digital ID could break the cycle of data breaches and identity theft?
Yes.
Yes.
I think it's necessary, but not necessarily sufficient.
Yes.
Yes.
And the final one, do you think it's worthwhile for Congress to consider legislation to restrict the use of unverified Social Security numbers and other personal information while promoting the use of secure digital identification?
I need to understand the proposition, how it's going to be, but essentially anything that can move us forward from a static number will be supportive.
Okay, same.
I agree.
Yeah. Ms. Mayer? Yeah, just for the record there, yes or no?
I don't know that my opinion matters, but yes.
Yeah.
I agree.
Yeah.
Yes.
Mr. Wilkinson, yes. The Trusted Identities Group is comprised of a public-private partnership to promote the adoption of an easy-to-use digital identity. And I'll just ask the final question here. I was wondering if you'd worked with this group, but since I'm running out of time here, will you commit to working with my office on ways to improve the current working group and expand its efforts?
Definitely.
Thank you. Mr. Smith? Yeah. Ms. Mayer? Yeah. Ms. Zachariah?
Absolutely.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you
yes.
very much, Mr. Chairman, and really appreciate you holding this hearing. I know that there was great interest on both sides of the aisle, and I think what I've seen today, I've been here for a long time listening today to the testimony, there are a lot of good ideas, and hopefully we can find a bipartisan way to really deal with a very tough situation. Thank you very much.
Agreed. Thank you, Senator Udall, my neighbor. From Minnesota, Senator Klobuchar.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. And I thought, given that I'm the last one here to ask questions, I would use this opportunity to welcome Mr. Wilkinson. I hope things have been going well from my home state here before us again. And Trust Data Card employs more than 2,200 workers worldwide and 800 of them in our state. So thank you for being here. So I'll start with you. And I know much of this ground has been covered, but not this exact question. In your testimony, you mentioned Brazil's model of issuing dynamic identities to citizens. And in this model, the government partners with industry to provide consumers options to access digital certificates for identification. How do they ensure it's private, that the government's private partners can keep citizens' information safe?
So some of the models that, you know, Brazil is a great example, but there's certain models, Senator, that we can share with you that are being used around the world that I wouldn't necessarily promote in the U.S. in terms of, you know, where the center of the trusted identity lies. But certainly the framework that they've built for secure identity is one that's very close to what we're proposing in terms of looking forward to the framework for secure identity going forward. Senator, the comment Senator Udall made just a few moments ago talking about NIST and the work that they're doing with the Trusted Identities Group is one that we follow very closely, and they're actually also doing really good work that we would love to spend more time with the committee speaking about and helping to describe what secure identity could look like in the future.
Okay, thank you very much. Mr. Smith appeared before us in Judiciary, and I think I expressed my the shared frustration I have with others in the Senate about what went on. But I thought I would focus with you, Mr. Barros, on what's happening now. So Equifax has announced that it would be launching this app, right, in January, that will allow consumers to lock and unlock personal credit data while providing consumers with more control over their credit information is a positive step. We don't want to have new avenues for hackers. So are there additional cybersecurity challenges that come with this mobile technology? And how is the product going to be tested?
The product has been developed as we speak. We are on time to deliver this in January. One of the advantages of the system is the simplicity of how consumers can actually understand and use the application to do that. We just started our development tests now, this is a strict connection to our main file, so it has all the security needs and requirements that will be make the product in compliance with security.
Okay. I've been working a lot, of course, on the election issue since I'm the ranking on rules, and we've been really concerned, Senator Graham and I have a bill to upgrade our election equipment. When we had attempts to hack 21 state elections equipment manufacturers or software companies. And so I see this as kind of going hand in hand with the attacks I've seen on some of my companies and like Target and other places. Ms. Mayor, you know, we have individual hackers and then we also have these state-sponsored attacks like what we believe occurred in the 2016 election. So. In your experience at Yahoo, how do state-sponsored attacks differ from those committed by individual hackers?
In many cases, the motivation is different. And I would also say that they tend to be much more sophisticated, much more
state-sponsored.
The state-sponsored tend to be much more sophisticated, persistent. They last for longer periods of time. They attack more targets. So they span over often several companies trying to stitch together a picture of what they're actually seeking. And they are very good at hiding their tracks. The four people indicted in the case with Yahoo, one of them, Alexei Balan, is considered to be perhaps the most sophisticated and dangerous hacker in the world today. And he's a central figure in many of these ongoing investigations. But when you're that empowered, well-funded, motivated, and sophisticated to work such a complex campaign, especially across multiple targets and sources, it's an issue.
So what do you think we could be doing differently for those kinds of state-sponsored attacks? What should we be doing out of Congress? When you look at the whole scope of things, the business, the government, the election equipment.
I think that really aggressive pursuit of the hacking is important. And I was really pleased with the FBI and Department of Justice's work with Yahoo to bring the people who perpetrated the crimes against us to justice. And I think that we should be empowering them legislatively and financially to pursue hacking, because right now there's just not enough of a disincentive to hack, either on a commercial or criminal level or a state-sponsored level.
These would be international cases, a lot of them, obviously, and then they could involve sanctions or other things if we find that. But that's what you're talking about, much more aggressive about doing, going after these, in addition to doing everything we can to protect the software.
Yes, and one of the individuals in the Yahoo case was apprehended in Canada and has been extradited to the U.S.
Mm-hmm. Good example. And I think on the election side, it's it's different. We have to get backup paper ballots. It's a one-time occurrence, but it is a lot of the same issues that business is facing as well. So thank you very much. Thank you.
Thank you, Senator Klobuchar. I think we... You guys made it through. We will keep the record open, and we'll allow members to submit questions for the record for a couple of weeks, but we will want to close it out. So if you could respond as quickly as you can in writing to the questions that the members of this committee submit, we'll get them included in the record. And again, appreciate all of you being here today. I think this has shed a lot of light on this subject, and as was mentioned earlier by a number of the members on both sides of this committee, we have an interest in moving forward on the legislative front in a way, hopefully, that will be effective in helping to prevent these types of cyber attacks in the future. So thank you again. And with that, this hearing is adjourned.
Okay, buddy.
All right, well done, Eames. Thanks.
Okay, bye.
Oops.